Oh, that pass is deep and open, and it's going to be a touchdown.
Nice cut by Maxwell, getting behind a block. They're going to take it in.
He's got a man. He's wide open. Get it in free. He's going to be gone. One touchdown and 2 yards. That one is up 29.
Looking across the middle. He's got a man wide open across the 40. He is all alone, and he could take it all the way. Touchdown, Blue Devils.
65
on the ISC Sports Network.
Rainy, chilly Friday, but the high school football postseason promises to take the chill off. Lafayette Jefferson, the venue tonight, as the Broncos host the Noblesville Millers. As you'll soon learn, this matchup defines contrasting styles. Hello, everyone. I'm Mark James, along with Mike Walensky. Tonight's game is brought to you by Riverview Health Westfield Hospital. It's now open, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. To learn more, visit riverview.org. Indiana University and Purdue University degrees from one urban campus. Visit iupui.edu. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise. Boqua Aquatic Fitness, an exercise program combining aquatics, athletics, and high-intensity interval training. It's a water workout your body will love for you. Grab your bugs and get wet. And by the city of Noblesville. The city of Noblesville would like to wish Coach Roden and the Millers good luck tonight. We are together. Again, Mark James with Mike Walensky tonight. And Mike, let's talk a little bit about these two ball clubs. As we mentioned, very much contrasting styles on display here tonight.
There's no doubt about it. For the Lafayette Jefferson Broncos, Pat Shanlon, his third year, has done a great job at 24-6. This is a team that loves to throw the football. They like to play on a fast track. And Maximus Grimes, a young quarterback, has really come on strong, throwing 42 touchdowns and just 5 interceptions and nearly 3,000 yards. He's got some great targets. They got good skill position. But at the same time, Lafayette Jeff has had a good group of guys up front defensively, been able to stop the run. That said, Noblesville, in Justin Roden's first year after winning a 4A state championship at East Central, he's 4-5, but they've been really competitive. They've lost to two top five teams by less than 10 points, Brownsburg 17-7, and last week they lost to Avon 14-7. In fact, in that Avon game, Mark, they had an interception that was picked off by defensive lineman Kenneth Jenkins for a touchdown that was called back. So it's just been this close, taking two steps forward and a step back for the Millers. Maybe tonight will be no Noblesville's evening.
Justin Roden under 500 his first year at East Central, but boy, did he turn it around. He went to a semi-state, a regional, and then last year won a state championship. He knows how to build a program and win football, but it's not a total rebuild at Noblesville. I mean, you know, our good friend Latchibe, Jason Simmons, you know, didn't have the success that either one of them necessarily wanted to have, but let's face it, plenty of athletes for Noblesville.
There's no doubt about it. On the defensive side, Zinnick has done a great job. Eddie's got 108 tackles coming this ball game. Impressed by Jacob Hamm, the linebacker number 47. He's done a real good job. And Zach Tuine, who's been on the shelf. A couple guys have been injured with the virus or something that's going around Noblesville. Tuine, number one, he's a good two-way player for Noblesville. There's talent on this roster. The challenge, I think, tonight, Mark, for Coach Roden, he's got four linemen out. And he's got to shuffle the way they block and shuffle positions, and that'll be a real key. Can they move the football on this good Jeff defense tonight?
I know it's a turf field, but let's face it, these conditions tonight, probably better news for Noblesville than for Lafayette Jeff.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. It slows things down to some degree, but having athletic turf and the fact it looks like it's not raining as much as it was earlier, this could help out Jeff as the ball game progresses. But generally, as this game starts, that'll be a key. The first 5 minutes could be the telltale in this ball game because Jeff is a fast starting ball club. They can get off on the right foot at home. They've got an advantage here.
Well, you know, Pat Shanley told me this week that they're a big play football team, and while he likes that, he thinks because of what Noblesville will try to do offensively, they need to extend their possessions as well. They'll take the big play if it's there. But, you know, they want to play some possession football, too, if the opportunity presents itself, because once you give the football to Noblesville, you may not get it back for a while.
That's right. And Noblesville's interesting because they're very similar in my mind, having seen the Harrison Raiders and Terry Peebles ball club, a ball club that prides itself on time of possession, on running the football. I think that Noblesville is the same kind of ball club. If they can handle the ball and not turn it over and move the chains forward, forward, it'll be important for quarterback Grant Gremmel to be very selective with the play calls from Coach Roden. They've got a chance.
So this is the Mulberry Health pregame show, by the way. Join us the second Tuesday of each month for our caregiver support group. We understand caring for a loved one can take a toll on its caregiver. It's a 24-hour job each day, and there are no weekends off. We quietly started a support group in May this year, and we're ready to grow. Call us today, 765-296-2911. Visit the website, mulberryhealth.com, for more information. Mulberry Health, your experience and our calling. And while we're taking a look at both of these ball clubs, Mike, and let's go ahead and talk about your keys to the game, the Haley's lock, safe, and keys to the game. Is your stuff safe at Haley's? We sell, install, and service locks, safes, keys, and much more. With over 50 years of experience, the team at Haley Lock, Safe, and Key can help you protect what you care about the most. Call us today, 765-447-5726, or visit haleyslock.com. Mike?
Mark, the most important part of this game is a start. How will these teams defend each other? If Lafayette Jefferson is allowed to get off to a quick start, it might be nights out for Noblesville. The first 5 minutes of each half will be very important. Secondly, maximize. Let me tell you, Maximus Grimes, a quarterback for Lafayette Jeff, if Noblesville cannot contain the passing game and cannot put pressure on Grimes, it's Jefferson's ball game to win. And then the third thing, the most important for both ball clubs, is who's going to win the battle in the trenches. I think the biggest concern for Noblesville coming in the ball game is how do you slow down Peyton Price, number 97. You'll see him play defensive tackle at 6'2", 292 pounds. He's a load. But Noblesville has some pretty good athletes at the tackle. One of them is a young Knight, who's, as you know, his older brother, plays at Indiana University. He's got some size, so it'll be interesting to see how Noblesville attacks offensively against a strong defensive front.
You mentioned the four starters that Coach Roden is without. You add to that Blevins, Blades, and Tuane. Those guys are starters. They've been battling illness of late, including pneumonia, so plenty of concerns for Noblesville coming into this football game. Let's go back to this quarterback, Maximus Grimes. You know, coaching staff said kid point guard last year as a freshman on their basketball team, one of the leading scorers in the area. But, Mike, as soon as the season was over, he got a hold of the receiving core and said, hey, let's start throwing together. Did it on his own. He organized it, put it all together. He and Brian Jenkins went on spring break together, really weren't friends prior to that. So that gives you an idea of the level of commitment. And, again, this kid's just a sophomore.
And that's a real key to this football team's success is their ability to pass the football. In fact, when you get to 6A, if you don't have balance, teams are smart enough to make you one-dimensional. Lafayette Jeff is a difficult team to make one-dimensional. And in that opening start at West Lafayette, we had similar conditions. It was raining. The difference, Mark, West Lafayette has grass. It really did slow things down. This turf might hold up a little bit better for Jeff in tonight's ball game.
Well, and, you know, Coach Shanley will tell you his ball club's a little older than they were that night. He had a very young secondary. They exploited that, as you recalled. And he said, quite frankly, that they probably heaped some expectation levels on Grimes that he wasn't quite ready for. But they said, you know, whatever they've thrown at him since, he has embraced it and worked his tail off to make it happen. And, you know, he said, that was a good find-out game for us. He said, we were disappointed with the loss most assuredly. But obviously, it helped their ball club go a long way toward running off the 8-in-a-row that they brought off.
Yeah, and that defensive secondary in the backside, Garrett Price, number 23, J.J. Lee, number 33, Janelle King, number 9, and Quentin Stephanie, number 3, have really started to play well. In fact, Stephanie, number 3, comes into the ball game with 2 sacks and 52 tackles. That's a pretty good number for a free safety for this Broncos ball club.
All in all, they're pretty lucky because they've been healthy. They come into this ball game healthy. He said they're not banged up at all. Talking about Lafayette Jeff, he said they're not banged up at all.
And that's a real positive thing coming to this ball game when you think of Noblesville, you know, having so many guys down. You can rely on these young men who have continued to compete in there and gain more experience. And as you know, in this tournament, the more experience you have, the more confidence a team, you know, develops. But you speak about confidence, leadership is really important. And you mentioned Brian Jenkins. Here's a senior at 6'2", 182 pounds, a receiver. He is the leading receiver for Lafayette Jeff. Get this, 48 receptions. He has 15 touchdowns. Not only that, but Matthews, Derek Matthews, the other receiver, the number two for Lafayette Jeff. The Broncos has 35 receptions, 11 touchdowns. Grimes has done a great job finding those young guys, and it's leadership and the young guys coming together at the right time.
That's a look at the Noblesville Millers and their brain trust as they head to the sidelines. That tells you we're just about ready to kick it off. We'll have the starting lineups for you at first quarter action when we come back.
Oh, that pass is deep and open, and it's going to be a touchdown.
Nice cut by Maxwell, getting behind a block. They're going to take it in.
He's got a man. He's wide open. Getting it free. He's going to be gone.
He has one touchdown and 2 yards. That one is up 29.
Looking across the middle. He's got a man wide open across the 40. He is all alone, and he could take it all the way. Touchdown, Blue Devils.
65
on the ISC Sports Network.
New. It's a sign of growth. A fresh start and full of possibilities. There's nothing like new. Introducing the new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. The brand new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, now open. Riverview.org.
Boqua is athletics, aquatics, and exercise put together in a fun, effective package that allows you to get in great shape safely, effectively, with a bunch of friends.
It is a low-impact exercise. It's not hard on your joints.
It helps me with my balance. It helps me keep my muscles flexible.
If I could do it 5 nights a week, I probably would.
People always tell you what not to do. Don't go too fast. Look, but don't touch.
Professor Mahan.
Don't ask questions.
How do we help startups succeed?
So for startup companies, the objective isn't profit.
Don't wake the neighbors. Find out what you can do. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise.
Pretty special, right? Where else can you get this?
No, pretty much anywhere.
What?
Oh, yeah, no, I meant Xfinity On Demand. You get it on all your devices, anytime, anywhere. But yeah, this you can only get here. Dude, where's your horse?
Who cares?
Awesome is having the most TV shows and movies anywhere with Xfinity On Demand.
At Mulberry Health, we support each member of our family in living a full, rich, meaningful life. Our experienced team of caregivers brings that mission to life each day. We treat each resident as an individual, from knowing how someone prefers their coffee to which activities they enjoy most.
I could not take care of my mom the way they take care of them here. I've just been very happy with my experience and my mom's experience here. I look forward to seeing my mom grow here.
Visit us online or come see us yourself. We would love to show you around.
Want to know what I like best about playing basketball for my high school? I like it because it's a place where my friends get to see me play. I like it because I'm playing for someone besides myself. I'm playing for everybody in my school and every person in my community.
Indiana High School Sports. They're more than just a game.
Come and see me play.
Thomas Phoenix Lawn and Garden is your local Husqvarna dealer. With us, you'll find a knowledgeable staff that's able to provide quick turnaround service so your business doesn't have to stop. From zero-turn mowers to trimmers and chainsaws, Husqvarna has you covered. And with the fleet program, the more you buy, the more you get in return. With that kind of stability, you can rely on us for the long haul. Get your Husqvarna equipment today at Thomas Phoenix Lawn and Garden, located at 6292 West County Road Zero in Frankfort.
Noblesville, Lafayette, Jeff, Mark Janes, Mike Walensky, set to bring you all the action tonight. And, Mike, I like the change that was made to the tournament for 6A. Instead of giving them a week off, essentially the semi-state round, you just move that to the other end. You start them in sectional play a week later. I think it makes a lot more sense.
It does make sense, and it's been a positive thing, I think, coming in this ball game, particularly for Noblesville. Gave them an extra week to get some of their kids back and ready to play for tonight's matchup.
So Lafayette Jeff won the toss and deferred, so they will kick it away to the Noblesville Millers. And Chase Cottrell is ready to kick it off. He drives it back toward the end zone. A clean return by Noblesville. A bit of a seam across the 35. That's Jaden Barrett, plenty of running room. Still cuts back inside to the 35, down to the 30, where he's finally brought down a drop. So a great start to the ball game by the Noblesville Millers.
Tremendous return by Jaden Barrett. He got a nice gap on the right side, Mark, after he got the football. And the Jeff defenders over-pursued the play, cut against the grain, and a great opportunity for the Millers in great field position. It'll be very critical for them to finish in the red zone. Mark, they have had trouble game in and game out finishing when they get in the red zone. It's been either a matter of penalties or lost plays. And Grant Gemmel, the quarterback, he's got to make plays tonight.
Hey, you got a peek at the quarterback and the rest of the starting offensive unit. That's a look at the Broncos defenses. We mentioned a very stingy defensive unit. Keep an eye on their middle linebacker, Britton Chandler, 43 solos, 43 assists, and 10 tackles for loss to go along with a couple of sacks. A stereotypical linebacker, and he is an active one. A gain of a couple on first down for the Millers. That's Blevins, who has 503 yards and a couple of touchdowns on the season. Peyton Price among those last to get off the pile at 6'2", 292, a sophomore. 9 hurries for him out of the defensive tackle position. 9 tackles for loss to go along with the 49 tackles. A great return by Jaden Barrett. You know, Mike, he averages 15 yards a return on the season, and he padded that average a little bit on that kickoff return. Rebel with the keeper gets it down inside the 20 to about the 19-yard line. So first down yardage for Noblesville.
Great call by Coach Roden. Jeff Broncos usually out of that base four down front. They had just 3 linemen, and nice blocking for the Noblesville Millers, including number 56, Dalton Davis. He's a senior at 6'2", 265.
Maris Nagoda, you saw earlier, the guards, along with Plecker and Knight, who are the tackles. So, good field position. Noblesville trying to take advantage of it now as they have the football first and 10 right at the 20-yard line, maybe just across it. Split backs now on first and 10. Little stop and go route, little hook, and that's the guy that got him the good field position. Jaden Barrett, forward progress, is going to give him a +4 just shy of the 15.
Garrett Price, number 23, the defensive back with 32 tackles this year, Mark, and he's got 2 interceptions. Lee, number 33, their other DB, has 4 interceptions. This football team has been fairly productive on the defensive end, taking away from the offense. Noblesville, again, they've got to produce here deep in the red zone.
13 catches for just under 200 yards on the season for Barrett. They've only scored 12 touchdowns as a team. I counted that twice to make sure I was right when we were putting the numbers together. Showing pressure, low snap, he gets it off, has a step into the end zone, touchdown pass complete to Jaden Barrett. Penalty marker down. We think it'll be on the defense, but we shall see.
Barrett had 13 receptions coming in the ball game, and they matched it up with Price, and they went back to him again. That matchup with Barrett and the Price, they really like it as they threw off the back shoulder. To me, I think that's a defensive pass interference. What are your thoughts?
Well, let's not forget, the touchdown is good. That is the call. Let's not forget that corner had to respect that hitch route that he ran earlier and completed. And I think he hesitated a little bit and he bit on. No, he didn't hesitate. He beat him right off the line of scrimmage. And you know the old saying is your defensive back coach, if he's even, he's leaving. And that's what he did. Touchdown.
And again, that's a good sign for Noblesville. We talked about how important the start is for this ball game. For the Millers, they start off well. They have a chance to compete, and they're doing it tonight.
Jack Knight to attempt the point after. Ball is down, the kick is up, and it is good. And off the outstanding kickoff return, it turned into the Jaden Barrett show early for the Noblesville Millers. And Mike, at the 9:50 mark of period one, they strike first, 7-0.
Well, that's what you have to do in a tournament ball game. You got to get off to a fast start. And as we know, teams that win championships are the teams that are most aggressive and normally win the battle in special teams. Now the Broncos have to come back and come up with an answer here for the Millers.
Yeah, what a series for Jaden Barrett. I mean, he gives them the great kickoff return, and then, you know, he completes the pass to him for first down, and then he turns around and scores on the touchdown a play or so later. So but great start for Noblesville. But as Mike mentioned, the challenge comes now for Noblesville to continue to do what they've done this season and play great defense.
No doubt about it. And, Jeff, defensively, they tried to crowd the line of scrimmage there and put pressure on the quarterback. But as I mentioned, that youngster, Grant Grimmel, did a great job of his poise, of hanging in there, making a nice throw.
Yeah, they assessed the penalty on the kickoff, so he'll boot it from the 50. Good look at Jack Knight, who's ready to kick it away. Among those deep is Bishop Johnson. Johnson will take it just shy of the goal line. He finds a little seam of his own, and he's tripped up at about the 20-yard line. They'll spot it at the 23. We talked about Max Grimes, who's thrown for almost 2,800 yards on the season, a talented receiving core. Brian Jenkins, his favorite target. Derek Matthews will get some looks, as will Bishop Johnson. Marquise Munoz, the running back, he has rushed for 792 yards on the season. There's that ultra-active Noblesville defense anchored by Zach Knoll, Kenya Jenkins, and Skylar Tolliver up front. Leach and Zenick, two outstanding linebackers for them. They'll throw it out the flat, little screen, great pressure by Noblesville, and coming up to make the stop, Zach Tuaday. You'll hear us call his name a lot as they throw them for a big loss, as that quick screen never materialized. Tuaday blew it up.
Yep, great call by Tuaday. He did a great job of reading that play, instantly saw it, and came screaming in from that left outside linebacker spot. He has 63 stops this year, also with 3 sacks.
A loss of 5, little stop and go. Pretty well defended by Noblesville. Jenkins was the intended target, but Noblesville had it blanketed.
On the backside, that was Johnson Sparks, number 2, defending on that play. Groover, by the way, another DB for the Noblesville Millers, comes in the ballgame tonight with 7 interceptions.
Tuaday's brother, of course, an MVP for Oregon the last time they appeared in the Rose Bowl, so pretty good bloodline there. Munoz comes in motion. They'll throw the screen out in the flat. He gets a block. He's to the 30. Breaks one tackle, gets to the 39-yard line, and a big third down pickup now as they send Munoz in motion. That's his 13th reception on the season.
Again, that shows the improvement of Grimes' arm strength, his ability to throw across the field. Great target, great strike, and Munoz is a guy you have to contend with, both running the football and throwing the football out of the backfield. He has 12 receptions this year.
A full throttle early on offensively as this completion goes to Derek Matthews. Almost 800 yards and 11 touchdowns for him. He averages 21 yards per catch.
One of the things that Jeff will do is they'll play up tempo, but they'll also spread the football all over the field.
Munoz on the run, first down to the 50. Nah, keeps it running, stumbles forward for a couple of more after impact. It looks like they'll spot it at about the 47-yard line. As we mentioned, Munoz has rushed for almost 800 yards, but he also has about 150 yards in receiving as well.
Good blocking there up front by the Broncos as Zenick finally had to make the tackle.
Seam route is complete. This time Zion Austin, who's technically listed as a tight end, was the beneficiary of that reception. Austin has caught 20 balls for close to 400 yards and has 7 touchdowns on the season. That too was a first down, this one inside the 35 to the 33.
They're really running tempo right now. Grimes doing a great job executing the offense for Coach Chandley's ball club.
And you see a shift defensively for the Noblesville Millers, taking a little longer off the snap now to let those linemen catch their breath a little bit. Little option look. Munoz has the corner, pushed out of bounds at about the 27-yard line. Justin Johnson Sparks from his corner position steps up to run him out of bounds.
You've got to contain the edge, and that time Tuna Mark had a bad angle. The outside linebacker blocked to the inside, gave up some good yardage.
Good look at Grimes. They do like that screen. They run it over and over and over again, and that means they have a receiving core that blocks very, very well. Matthews knocked out of bounds. They say he stepped out, perhaps at around the 15-yard line. We'll see where the final spot is. It is indeed the nose of the football, just barely touching the 15-yard line, and they are set and ready already for the far hash. Marquise Munoz runs into Zach Knoll, Kenya Jenkins, and Skylar Tolliver, so nothing doing on that carry.
Good job by the Noblesville linemen defensively there. Jenkins, as you mentioned, number 42, did a good job. The Jeff Broncos lineman there, a little bit slow and got the pads up high. Noblesville got underneath.
Grimes with a snap. They show a little jet sweep motion, throw it underneath. Ball bobbled, almost picked off.
Those are the kind of interceptions Gruber has been able to make all season long for Noblesville to keep in the ball game. That time, nearly a pick. Right down the seam there. Ball was tipped by Austin and then nearly an interception. Make that number two. That's Matthews.
Matthews again, the intended target. As we mentioned, he averages just under 22 yards per catch. A third and nine situation for Lafayette Jeff.
Noblesville's had to be careful here. There's no safety in the middle of the field. And fortunately for them, the Broncos run the football. Otherwise, I think there's going to be an opportunity for a touchdown and an open field down the middle as the linebacker Ham did a good job of filling the gap there.
Munoz to the 11. It's a fourth down at about five, and they are not bringing the kicking unit onto the field. Out of the spread, Munoz is single back. They've assessed the defense. Now they look over for the call.
You have to be concerned, too, about Munoz coming out of the backfield here.
And there he goes. Had success the other way with that. They'll try it this way, and it pops off the shoulder pads, and Noblesville holds on fourth and seven.
Well, I think they have the right call made because I think Munoz, if he catches the ball, he's able to turn the corner, but he took his eye off the football there right at the last minute. He saw Tuna coming in top of him and drop the football. That is a huge mistake for the Broncos early on in the ballgame.
I think I would notice him if he was headed my way. Healthy Communities offers free monthly health screenings throughout Clinton County. These screenings are free and open to all. For locations and more information, visit healthyclintoncounty.org. Happy to have you with us. Looks like Mother Nature, Mike, is starting to cooperate a bit. I think things have dried up a bit down on the field.
It is, and it's a little bit easier to toss the football around. Though Lafayette Jeff made the mistake there on the pass play, they still win the battlefield position. They flip the field.
Gremmel on the keeper, and there is just absolutely nowhere to go. Peyton Price didn't make the tackle, but he was the guy that really kind of bottled it up, Mike. They had nowhere to go.
No doubt about that. And Matthew Copen, the linebacker, number 34 in the play at 6'4", 200 pounds. And again, Cross, the number 82 defensive end, he's a handful too. So they got two guys at both sides. You have to be concerned with DeMarco Cross, number 82, a junior, 6'3", 206 for Pat Chanley's Broncos.
There's some full-figured boys in that picture right there. I mean, that's scrum that developed right there at the line of scrimmage. I mean, there are some guys that are trying to move some mass around for sure. A loss of about one, second and 11, a low snap, little pump fake. He throws it up the left side and just over the outstretched arms of his intended target, Jaden Barrett, who's been the star of things offensively for Noblesville thus far. And Mike, if they can hold him here, it kind of gives you a mindset as to why Pat Shanley didn't look to kick that field goal earlier, because they're going to flip the field position in their favor, clearly, if they can hold him here on third and 11.
No doubt about it. And Steven Stephanie, number 14, the DB, did a good job on the receiver there. The defense was in a pass prevent situation. They only had three down linemen rushing the passer.
The corners played awfully soft at the bottom of the screen. They run a slant instead. They throw a route underneath, and that's a miscommunication. Somebody ran the wrong route.
Well, he's looking for Blevins coming out of the backfield, number seven. Blevins is the second leading receiver for Noblesville this year with 10 receptions, but that is a big mistake because now the punter is going to be probably kicking the ball from the end zone, and you got to make a good long snap here.
And Brandon Lowe was all by his lonesome, and Lafayette Jeff's Brain Trust pointed that out as they came off the field. So Garrett Price will drop deep to receive the punt. And that's a knuckleball that's going to get on the ground. It's going to bounce a little bit before it's down at about the 40-yard line.
Boy, not a good punt for Noblesville. I think they wanted a little bit more distance, so that looked like he kicked the ball off the side of his foot, and Jeff wins the battle. They get the ball back in great field position.
Jack Knight punts it up to the 40-yard line. Knight on the season is averaging just under 40 yards per punt. Looks like the rain has picked up once again.
It's come back. It's come back, and maybe that's a result of that kick coming off the foot so slowly off the punter there.
So Munoz, the single back. Grimes, surprise, surprise, looking for the deep ball here. He has a man wide open. Touchdown just like that to Derek Matthews. A 12th touchdown on the season for Derek Matthews, a 40-yard quick strike. Just the thing Justin Roden said he could not have happened tonight.
Nope, he had Justin Johnson Sparks, the DB, looking into the backfield instead of looking at the receiver there, and Brian Jenkins made him pay. There it is, beautiful toss by Grimes, 16th touchdown of the season. He beat him by 3 or 4 yards. Like I said, Sparks was looking in the backside of the backfield and wasn't focused on the receiver.
Cottrell to attempt the point after. Quinton Stephanie will hold. Their long snapper is Matthew Coppin, and we like to give those guys a lot of credit because they have a tough job, particularly on a night like tonight. Flag is down. Looks like maybe somebody from Noblesville was lined up in the neutral zone. The kids from the Broncos immediately look to the sidelines and say, hey, if we get those yards, are we going to go for two here? And it doesn't look as though they're going to. They'll turn that penalty down and look to tie it here with 5:39 to play the first quarter. That kick is good. So a quick strike after the defense stiffened just a little bit. And with 5:39 to play in the first quarter, we are tied at 7. A pretty impressive drive to call it even here between Noblesville and Lafayette Jeff as sectional action continues here tonight.
Keep up to date with your favorite high school, college, and semi-professional teams on the ISC Sports app. Download it today from the App Store, Google Play, or on Roku. The ISC Sports Network. Local lives here.
New. It's a sign of growth. A fresh start and full of possibilities. There's nothing like new. Introducing the new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. The brand new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, now open. Riverview.org.
I want to thank all our fine sponsors tonight, including the City of Noblesville. The City of Noblesville obviously is Miller proud, and they are as one saying, go Millers tonight. So Jaden Barrett, the guy who did all the damage on the opening kick, is ready to receive another attempt. We'll see if they attempt to kick it away from him, although that may be a bit difficult to do on a night like tonight. This time it is a short kick, and it's going to go out of bounds, which will give them possession at the 35-yard line, assuming that's where they want it, and we think they probably will. Noblesville 7-5 in 2001, Mike. That's the last season above 500. 2001. Lance Scheib got to 500 twice. Craig Barr once prior to Coach Scheib. They did win sectional titles in 79, 97, and in 2000. They lost 25-7 to Carmel 1 year ago. So the Noblesville, they've had those years 5-5. Been around 4-5 and 4-6 and just always looking to just get over that hump and string two or three or four good seasons together.
Yeah, it's really been difficult, too, for them because of the growth of all the schools in Hamilton County with Fishers and Hamilton Southeastern, and then on the west side with Avon and Brownsburg. But I think Coach Roden's got himself a chance here to really make some things happen because I think this grassroots program at Noblesville is awfully good.
Greb carries the football forward for a gain of about 3 to the 40, and Justin Roden had some concerns coming into this ball game in terms of his quarterback being a little beaten and bruised with pressure coming when they decided to throw the football. But it looks as though that they're going to do but what Pat Shanley feared they might, Mike, and that is try to play ball control football. I think that's their best chance.
There's no question about it. It's their best chance because that's what they do best. I think when they start throwing the football, that creates some problems for them. Look at Gremmel. Good job of running the ball.
Really nice cut block on the corner, too, that was able to spring him. And he's going to have a first down carry across the 45 to the 46.
Well, Dalton Davis is doing a good job so far blocking at center number 56, doing a really good job taking out the nose tackle there. And he's getting some help there up front by Garrett Plecker, number 50, and also number 66, Michael Maris, a big 275-pound junior.
Britton Chandler, 5'11", 216, and a senior. I think those are the numbers you want as a middle linebacker, are they not? I mean, that's pretty impressive, really.
No doubt about that.
He's going to run it for the third time. He's not going to find a lot of room. He may have gotten a yard before he's wrapped up by Peyton Price. We talked about Price, a 300-pound sophomore with 49 tackles, 9 of those for loss. Forward progress will give him about the length of the football.
Justin Rands checked in the ball game, a sophomore linebacker, mark number 35 for the Broncos. He also did a good job of closing that gap there, 6'1", 194. I think the Broncos have some depth. They're starting to rotate some guys in and out the front seven.
Second and 9 for Gremmel now. Single setback. See a slot come in motion. That's Barrett. And the snap was fumbled, and the quarterback was able to follow the football.
There's been some tough exchanges between Davis and Gremmel early on in this ball game, and perhaps part of it is the rain starting to come down. It is slick outside, and there is a huge assignment when you think about some of the guys they got to block up front with Price and Cross and some of those other folks from the Jeff Broncos. They're pretty good front group.
Loss of 2 now. Rolling toward the final 3 minutes of this opening quarter, tied at 7, as you can see. Bad snap. He picks it up. Chased down and dropped at about the 29-yard line. DeMarco Cross with 9 tackles for loss and 46 tackles on the season. He's the one that put the pressure on and was the beneficiary of the bad snap.
And Cross got outside and passed the right tackle there and probably wouldn't have gotten the sack had the ball not been snapped so poorly. But again, look at it rain outside. It's raining hard. This long snapper now really has a lot of pressure to get the ball back to the punter.
Now Jack Knight gets a good punt this time and gets it away a little cleaner, but it's going to be a short kick. It's going to bound down and take a bit of a Noblesville bounce. Looks like they'll spot it at around the 40-yard line. So that's where the second possession will begin for Lafayette Jeff. Riverview Health Westfield Hospital is now open, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. To learn more, visit riverview.org.
One of the challenges defensively tonight, as good as Noblesville is, Mark, is that Lafayette Jeff will throw everything at you. You can't focus on one aspect of their offense because they can throw and they can run the football, and sometimes Pat Shanley has some tricks up his sleeve.
They'll run the dive play to Grimes off the play action, and he's still going to be able to squeeze about 4 out of it. I like him. I mean, he's a serviceable back for sure. Munoz gets another carry. They find something they like as he has first down yardage to the 45. We talked about him, Mike. Almost 800 yards and 9 touchdowns. We've seen him get into the act in the receiving department. 212 receptions for about 130 yards on the season.
Well, Dalton May, Mark, at the center, number 58, just had a pancake block on one of the Millers. He's done a really good job up front.
And we've got a false start charged against Lafayette Jeff.
Yeah, you don't run those 750 yards without having a really solid offensive line. And as we saw, Dalton May with a nice block up front. Also, the left tackle, Colton Lennon, number 50. He's also a sophomore, 6'2", 224. He had a nice block up front as well. As you see, that rain just keep hammering down on the field here.
style of football. I'll tell you, not enough credit Mike's given to the offensive linemen, the way they're able to get up to the line of scrimmage and get set. I mean, it's one thing for backs and receivers to get set, but for these linemen to do it, it's just amazing. Pretty good coverage by Groover. We expect that out of him. I mean, he's the real deal out of that cornerback position. So he limits them to a short gain as Matthews was there on the reception.
At some point in time, Noblesville has got to find a way to get in the backfield, start putting pressure on Grimes, because the offensive line is just doing a good job and just stonewalling him at the point of attack.
Got 4 yards of the loss back, and Munoz, the ball carrier, being a little more stingy, the interior of the Noblesville defense. Ham and Leach and Zenick comes up. They came up with support from their linebacker position, but I think defensive end Skylar Tolliver was there first.
Yeah, and Jenkins, number 42, really fighting through a couple blocks there to help out. And Jenkins, you know, up front has 75 tackles. That's a pretty good number for a down lineman.
Big third down and 10 for both ball clubs, most notably Noblesville. They go to Matthews out in the flat. He gets a block. He's free to the 40, finally bumped out at about the 35-yard line. And one thing's for sure, this receiving core, Mike, is not only brought into the fact that they're going to see the football a lot, but the way they block is impressive to me.
Great blocking, great yards after catch. There's the block right there. Now, there could have been a block, but he did release. And then you saw number 7 downfield for the Lafayette Jet Broncos, Bishop Johnson, with another solid block. And, boy, this offense is really starting to move.
Yep, Skylar Tolliver was the one there to make the tackle of finally. As we're getting close to the final seconds now of period number 1, 5 yards the reception to Brian Jenkins. Now they'll go back to Munoz, and Munoz gets it across the 25, just shy of the 20, and that will take care of first quarter action with Noblesville and Jeff tied at 7. And let's face it, Lafayette Jeff is poised for 7 more, at least, when we come back here at sectional play.
So in 2014, I introduced Defining Looks Wig Hair and Nail Salon to the Lafayette area, where we can offer you the most fashion-forward, up-to-date wigs.
Take you in a private room, show you different styles, so people don't even realize that you have a wig until you say, oh, thanks, but it's a wig.
It will feel like it's your hair, and you will walk out feeling confident and beautiful. You will be ready to join the world.
Boqua is athletics, aquatics, and exercise put together in a fun, effective package that allows you to get in great shape safely, effectively, with a bunch of friends.
It is a low-impact exercise. It's not hard on your joints.
It helps me with my balance. It helps me keep my muscles flexible.
If I could do it 5 nights a week, I probably would.
Oh, we thought Mother Nature was going to cooperate.
Yeah.
But, looks like we're getting wet. Well, we're not. We're high and dry, thankfully. Hey, our goal is to make life as full, rich, and meaningful as possible for you and your family. Call us today, 765-296-2911, or visit the website, mulberryhealth.com. Mulberry Health, your experience, our calling. And just like that, the start the quarter. They're going to get to the end zone talking about Lafayette Jeff. Zion Austin, the beneficiary that time. And as we mentioned, he gets his share of balls, Mike. 20 catches for 400 yards and 7 TDs out of that slot position.
Yeah, great job of Pat Shanley moving around in the backfield. Slipped in underneath, but that Noblesville defense is trying to stay tight here. Good job by Dalton Davis getting the pads down to make the tackle along with Jenkins.
Well, there's a penalty marker down, but my apologies on the previous play. I thought he had gotten to the end zone. I thought I saw a signal, but obviously he was stopped short. I'm sure Noblesville likes their call better than mine on that.
Illegal substitution against the Millers.
Defense probably did not get off in time because they were in a goal line situation and had to adjust personnel.
And this offense has really found its rhythm. And again, I really like the way Coach Shanley used Zion Austin in the backfield, and they slipped him out there underneath. Linebacker didn't pick him up, and Grimes is very efficient with the football, particularly tonight.
Grimes on the keeper, waiting for the signal, and he gets it. Touchdown on the keeper. Grimes has carried it 38 times on the season, just 170 yards. That's his second rushing touchdown of the year. Not much call for him to run the football when he can throw it for 2,800 yards on the season, I don't think, Mike.
No doubt about that. He's got great arm strength, and I'm really impressed by his delivery tonight. He's really improved from the beginning of the season. He's become an outstanding gunslinger. I mean, he can really throw the football, particularly the deep ball. Very impressed by that this evening so far.
Really important drive, I think, coming up, Mike, for Noblesville. I mean, I know it's just 14-7, but the last possession offensively, last two, in fact, did not go very well. And you know, after the good start and the momentum that they got off the opening kick and then the quick score after that, you know, the defense on their heels a little bit, struggling to stay with this up-tempo offense. And I think this series, for both their defense and the offense, very, very important for Noblesville.
I think you've said it. I mean, this is an important part of the ball game for this Noblesville Miller Ball Club. We know what the team 4-5, psychologically, they may be a touch fragile once they get down by a couple of touchdowns. So it'll be very key for them to keep in this ball game closely, particularly the fact that we know Noblesville doesn't throw the football much and they don't put up a lot of points on the board.
Coach Shanley, 6-4 in his first year as head coach, went 10-1 a year ago. He was an assistant the one year that Brian Moore was here when they went 8-3. And he said, you know, he feels pretty good about the overall health of this program and his stamp being on it since he was here with Coach Moore for that one year. And he said, you know, everybody from the sixth grade on up pretty much does what they do. And that is so, so very important when you're trying to build some tradition and consistency here.
No doubt about it. And Lafayette Jeff traditionally has had a very good, solid football program. And it looks like they're back this year. And last year as well. They're trying to make a statement here at 6A.
And the ball goes out of bounds again. That means Noblesville will get a start at the 35. And I asked him about kids getting looks and offers and things of that nature. And he said, you know, sometimes we're a little hidden here. And he said, the bottom line is this. If our kids want to start drawing attention, he said, we've got to get to a big stage. We've got to get to a semi-state round. We've got to get to a state championship. He said, you'd like to think in this day and age that coaches will find you, but he said, there's no question getting on that big stage helps all of those schools that are normally there and their kids get looked. So that's what he's challenged his kids to do, get on the big stage and then they see you front and center. And I think that's a great point.
Yep, they've had some really good football players here over the years. Quarterback Doug Downing, Dustin Keller, great tight end who played football with the Purdue Boilermakers and the New York Jets, and now has a business, roofing business in this area with his brother, and Rick Skabinski, a number of folks for the Broncos.
Looking to throw some pressure, and I think we're probably going to have a hold. Max Pollard was the intended target there, and pressure came from the interior. I believe Peyton Price was among those to put pressure on. So we mentioned how important this drive was for Noblesville. It doesn't get off to a very good start as they're faced with a holding penalty. And, you know, Mike, compounding that is the fact that that flag was laid on the ground about 7 yards behind the line of scrimmage. And, of course, withholding being a spot foul, that puts you in a really big hole on first down.
That's a huge issue, and I think the holds on Garrett Plecker, the left tackle, number 50, was holding on to Broncos' defensive end there at the last minute. And that is costly because these guys for the Broncos really get after the quarterback.
Plenty of size up front for Noblesville. The tackles are around 230 to 250, and the guards are the 285-270 range, and Dalton Davis, the center, at 265. Lafayette Jeff giving a hint of pressure, and now they drop Britton Chandler back a little bit. And it's clear that they feel like that their best chance to run the football is with their quarterback tonight. He does continue to get positive yards, but the issue is after the hold was spotted 7 yards behind the line of scrimmage, it's a big hole to dig out of.
Well, Justin Rand, the linebacker, was forced to make the tackle there because one of the bright sides is when they run the football, Noblesville's offensive line has did a good job in engagement. They are moving the Jeff defensive line off the line of scrimmage.
You want to try to get half of it here, I think, Mike, on 2nd and 24 if you can. Pressure coming. He throws it across his body and has to throw it out of bounds.
Let me just say one thing. You've got to be aggressive defensively if you want to move up in this tournament. And Coach Chandler sent another linebacker, number 34, Matthew Copen, on the blitz there. And without that, he's going to sit back there and throw the football all day. You've got to be aggressive, and that sends a signal to your ball club early on in this ball game, early on in this tournament, that you're here for business.
Now it's a situation where you just try to give yourself a little bit more room, get up the field from where you are. Obviously, chances of converting on 3rd and 24 aren't good, but you need to get something out of it. So they're going to settle for the draw to Blevins, and Blevins is going to pick up about 6, get it to about the 26-yard line. But I think when all this said and done, with some of the issues that Jack Knight has had kicking it away, this is going to work out very, very well for Lafayette Jeff.
It will, and another great effort for the Broncos. Caden Satters, number 40, another sophomore at 6 foot, 268 pounds, comes swinging over from the backside to make the tackle.
So as we mentioned, Knight to kick it away. 23, Garrett Price is among those who have dropped. That's not a bad kick, but it's a line drive, and it's going to result in a pretty decent return for Lafayette Jeff. And they get the ball across the 50. Quinton Stephanie on the return gets it to about the 48-yard line of Noblesville.
And he does a good job of protecting the football, which is vital in this ball game with the rain coming down. And Noblesville, their challenge, Mark, in this first half is the center snap. If they can make some things happen, the center snap, they've got some chances to make positive yardage. It's really costing them here this evening.
Stephanie right around his average on return of 6. Good hard run by Munoz. I just like what he brings to the ball club. I mean, let's face it, they've got all kinds of athletes who can throw it all over the field, but he is a really a deceptive runner in terms of how hard he runs the football. He's plus 3 to the 45. Grimes looking for a chunk. Pretty good defense, but a better catch by Derek Matthews. Can't do much more than Justin Johnson Sparks did.
Aggressive play calling. You would think with the rain coming down, they maybe try to keep the football on the ground, but they run the play action and a great toss by Grimes.
Already set to the 16. A quick shot out in the flat to Derek Matthews, and that goes nowhere as they bottle him up pretty well. Justin Johnson Sparks there again defensively. Pickup of about 1. I'll tell you who this is probably hardest on, Mike. That's the chain gang across the way.
Yeah.
They have a hard time running 30 yards upfield, getting set right away. Grimes, Munoz, slips through one tackle, still on his feet, down inside the 5 to the 3. How about that run?
Tremendous run by Munoz off the right side. And good blocking up front, but just a good set of legs by this young man off the right side. Look at that double block there, 71, 72. Nice job of breaking that tackle inside and just forward and driving those legs forward for the Broncos. They are in scoring position once again.
Grimes to Munoz, ball loose on the ground, and it looks like he was able to get it back. That previous run by Munoz, they probably give a lot of credit there to Greg Dunkel. He's the strength coach, and he is the guy that Pat Shanley said has made a tremendous difference in this program.
Well, their strength definitely is a huge factor in this ball game, although give Noblesville's offensive line some credit, too, for some of the stalemates here. But right now, boy, this offensive line for Jeff is really holding its own.
Pick up about a yard and pretty good defense. And again, that was Justin Johnson Sparks. The intended target was Brian Jenkins. Jenkins, not an easy guy to cover. He's got 48 receptions and about 850 yards and 15 TDs on the season. Mike, he averages almost 18 yards per catch.
I tell you what, Zion Austin, number 10, when they put him in the backfield there and threw the ball right down the middle, that might be another play they might go to once again.
He drops back. They throw the screen to the backside. Zinnick. And how about that play by Zinnick? We talked about how active he was going to be. 62 solo tackles and 6 tackles for loss for Eddie Zinnick, the 5'10", 200-pound linebacker.
Eddie Zinnick, total tackles this year, over 108 coming in the ballgame. You mentioned 60 solos. The blocker there just getting out late, trying to pull on the play, number 50, Colton Lennon, the left tackle, now forcing the Broncos for a field goal. That's a win for the Millers defense.
Armani Williams set to attempt the point after. No check that, sorry. That's Elijah Marquez. The ball is up,
left,
and it is no good. So a bit of a defensive stand there by the Noblesville Millers, and that's got to put a little bounce in their step.
Well, he hooked it wide left, just missed it by a couple feet, and I think the timing was just a little bit off as the snap was high. And that's a win for the Millers.
One urban campus, more than 350 academic programs awarding Indiana University and Purdue University degrees. Visit iupui.edu, IUPUI, fulfilling the promise.
The question here, Mark, is do they put Gremmel under center? They continue to have that snap from Davis, which has been problematic throughout the course of the first half for the Millers.
They just need a few first downs here, Mike. I mean, I know they want to come away with points, but, boy, if they could put together a good sustained drive here, and that is a great throw and a great catch in traffic. It's going to result in a pickup of about 9 before they're swarmed under by several Lafayette Jeff defenders.
One of those defenders is Monroe, number 19. This year he has 32 tackles, but of those, he's got 3 sacks. So he's a guy that you might see blitz from the outside there. He's playing on the boundary side of the defense.
Zach Gruber, one of those guys that will play on both sides of the football, had the reception there. Give him plus 9 and bring up a manageable second down and 1. Quarterback keeper, first down and then some. Good, strong run delivered a blow up to the 35-yard line.
Well, one thing's for certain right off the bat, it appears that Noblesville is trying to run away from Peyton Price, number 97, the big defensive tackle. They ran to the right side of their formation. Price was lined up to the other side.
Matthew Coppin on the tackle, playing, getting some snaps defensively now. From the 35, first and 10 for Noblesville. What Coach Roden would like to do here, move the chains. Oh, he had a receiver open in the seam, and he missed him. But a good job of staying alive and a great job of tiptoeing to the out-of-bounds line and making the reception. Hauling it in for the Noblesville Millers is Wyatt Blades, his first reception. And watch the body control here and the presence of mind to get the feet down.
Boy,
just inside the line.
Well, great job of getting the feet in by Blades. But again, that offensive line is having fits with Peyton Price. They need 2 guys to block him.
A bad snap, and this just kills you.
Yep.
Just kills you.
And Monroe again, number 19, the corner coming in quickly and making the play. Yeah, the whole evening so far has been slowed down offensively because of bad snaps here. It's really slowed down a lot of drives for Noblesville in this ball game.
Loss of about 12. They had a very manageable second down situation now. Now it's third and a big mid bunch, and a drive that was going your way is in danger of stalling out on third and 15. Gremmel has some time this time, floats it out there and threw it too high for his intended target, Zach Gruber. So that'll bring up a punting situation for Noblesville. And, you know, Mike, the self-inflicted wounds are just the toughest to swallow for a ball club.
It'll pull somebody's hair out. And Coach Roden wasn't very happy about last week's Noblesville Miller blocking. Tonight, that center snap is really hurting them.
Garrett Price, Quentin Stephanie, deep to return the punt. Neither are going to get an opportunity to do so, as this one is going to be spotted out of bounds at about the 31-yard line.
Well, they did flip the field just a little bit, but as you know, they had some momentum there. Offensively, they had a first down, and they were running the football, and all of a sudden, a bad snap really cost them. And now the Broncos have a chance to come back, and the way things are going, I wouldn't be surprised Pat Shanley throws it up in the air.
Grimes with Twins to the top of the screen on first and 10. And it's dropped.
Wow, there was a perfect opportunity to Bishop Johnson. I think he may have taken his eye off the football at the last minute. Nice play action. Good job by Maximus Grimes there, the quarterback.
Yeah, that's not the run-pass option there. That's just a move to design to freeze those linebackers a bit, and it did, and he was open, just took his eye off of it. On second and 10, a little bit of pressure, steps out of it, fires it deep up the field, and coming back, making a nice adjustment to the football, is Derek Matthews.
Derek Matthews, once again, a great catch there. That ball was slightly underthrown, but once again, he beat Justin Johnson Sparks. Number 2 on number 2. Look at that one.
He does a good job of finding single coverage situations, doesn't he, as a quarterback?
He does.
I mean,
nice job.
They exploit that. How about that? I tell you, I like Munoz. I do, Mike. I mean, he's doing a great job running the football, and he's giving them balance, which I think is something that Coach Chandler really likes to see.
And so far, Mark, he is holding on the football because it's cold out there and it's wet.
Yeah, and Justin Roden is going to take a timeout here and talk things over. We talked about him being in his first year at Noblesville. And we'll talk more about the coach that came from East Central off a state championship when we come back to Lafayette Jeff.
We love to see you here at the Farmers Bank. However, we know there are times you need to bank on your schedule, wherever you may be. With the Farmers Bank mobile banking app, you can check balances, transfer funds, pay bills, and now you can also securely deposit checks with your smartphone by simply taking a picture of the check. Download our mobile banking app today. The Farmers Bank, your local bank, your mobile bank, your bank for life.
Justin Roden, 4-7 in his first year at East Central, Mike, and then he went on in 2015 to win a semi-state championship, in fact, won a regional in 2016 before winning it all in 2017. He was 47-20 and really had done a great job at East Central. As we get back to action, pass complete, a couple of moves by Bishop Johnson buys him a few more yards. And, you know, East Central is not a program that was a total rebuild job. You remember Rod Ballard won a state championship, had some great teams down there for years.
That's a tough place to play football. It's a tough place to compete against in general. They've got really nice facilities down at East Central. But for Lafayette Jeff, for Maximum Grimes to go back to Bishop Johnson after he just dropped a pass, that shows a sign of confidence for this offensive unit in this wide receiver.
From the 15, it's 1st and 10. They'll go to Munoz again, and it looked like he had a bit of a seam, and then all of a sudden he gets swallowed up. And Skylar Tolliver from his defensive end position was there to wrap him up. A really good job of getting off the corner and turning the play in by Tuane.
Now we've got an empty backfield. This is going to put even more pressure on Noblesville, and someone has to account for Grimes. I mean, Grimes can run the football if he chooses to. He's a pretty good athlete.
Look at single coverage, top of the screen, and he underthrew him just a little bit, but he was able to get his hands underneath the football. Was Brian Jenkins to make the reception to the 10. A little surprised with that one-on-one coverage over there that they went with that little hitch route. They had four receivers stacked to the high side, and now they'll go trips to the bottom of the screen and dispatch Munoz to the backfield again.
Groover, number 6, he's a pretty good defender.
3rd down and 5, Munoz goes in motion looking for the slant in the end zone, and it's caught by guess who? Brian Jenkins. He finally gets into the act. He had scored 15 touchdowns coming into play. The favorite target, and as we mentioned, these two went on spring break together to get to know one another. Really weren't even friends prior to last spring break.
And Groover, as I said before, is a pretty good defender over that time. I tell you, Jenkins made it look easy. And the thing about Grimes is he's got a tremendous touch. I love the way he throws the football.
Marquez to attempt the point after now. Ball is down, the kick is up, and it is good. So Noblesville had a drive underway. A bad snap stalled it. Lafayette Jeff was able to capitalize, and they jump out to a 21-7 lead. All is not lost for Noblesville, though, Mike. We keep saying it with every possession. They can feel pretty good about themselves going into the locker room. Not saying necessarily they need to come away with a score here, although that'd be ideal. But Mike, let's face it, they need to keep Jeff off the board before we get to intermission, especially considering the Broncos get the ball to start the second half.
No doubt about it. The game is about momentum, and right now momentum is in the Broncos' favor, and the Millers have to get it back. And I do think, Mark, it's important for them to get on the board here in the second period. They do need to score points. Psychologically, being down by 2 touchdowns when you're on the road, and Jeff, as we know it, deferred. So they're going to have the kickoff to begin the third period. Noblesville has to make something happen, and they can. Their offense has shown that they can move the football if they don't self-destruct. Tonight, much like portions of the season, they have been their own worst enemy.
You need to see if they can get the ball back to Barrett. He had a good return to set up their opening scoring drive, and he averages about 15 yards a return. So, as they get set now with 3:43 to play in the half, Noblesville trying to slow this offensive juggernaut. They could just beat you in so many ways with so many people. This is a short kick, taken at the 30. Wrapped up and dropped at about the 35-yard line. Decent return by Eddie Zenick.
And the Millers have really good field position. Now, relative to that, as you see, there's 3:37 left to go in the second period. Lafayette Jeff being in the driver's seat. Their defense can hold Noblesville. They still can manage the clock and get points on the board. That's why it's so important for Noblesville to have a good drive and convert, get some points here before the half to change momentum. It's very important for this ball club right now with their backs to the wall.
Another drive that starts at the 35-yard line, not because this one went out of bounds, though. And they decided to opt away from that, and they've done a pretty good job of keeping it away from Barrett after he had that big return on the opening kickoff.
Yeah, no doubt about it. With the rain, it really slows down the track.
Hillman, Blevins in the backfield. Blevins is the guy that'll get the carry, and he has good yardage on first down. Give him three, maybe four. Again, Dalton Davis, Nagoda, Michael Maris up front, along with Cameron Knight and Garrett Plecker. Their opposite side is Peyton Price and Caden Sowers, along with DeMarco Cross and Jared Nault.
Justin Rand, Mark, number 35, has been very quick, the linebacker here. He's made a lot of tackles in the running game. A lot of credit, though, to the defensive line for holding up those blockers.
Blevins carries it across the 40 to the 38-yard line. You see Zenick, he stayed in the ball game, and we talked about him defensively. Zenick's actually carried the ball 31 times for just shy of 200 yards and scored a couple of touchdowns, but I think with his bulk and his beef, they by and large use him as a blocking back, and as we say that, he will come to the sidelines.
Well, this is a big play here. They run the football. If Jeff can stop them prior to the chains, they may want to call timeout. They would like to get points on the board here to extend this lead.
Timeout, and Lafayette Jeff is going to talk over the little change in the formation. They made an adjustment there, Noblesville did. Joe Hillman, the fullback who we've seen get spot duty, Mike, he lined up right in that gap between the left guard and the center, and I think it was pretty obvious that that's where they were looking in terms of getting the 3 yards that they needed, and a great set of eyes by the Lafayette Jeff Broncos. And let's not, we spend a lot of time talking about this offense. I mean, the defense no slouch for Lafayette Jeff either. I mean, they've been a little stingy from time to time this year.
They have been, and they've been really good on the backside. They really attacked the defensive line. I talked about Price and Cross, those two guys up front, and Wyatt, we haven't mentioned him much. Number 24 hasn't played much, but he comes in the ballgame with 71 tackles, one of the leaders in this Broncos ball club. And they've got some depth, and so far I've been very impressed by the speed of Justin Rand, the linebacker, number 35.
18 sacks on the season for them, 10 interceptions. So they get a little stingy defensively, as we said. The spot, I think, is going to be a little short by Blevins. So it'll be fourth down and the length of the football, the decision-making time for Justin Roden. Actually, they're not going to give him a very good spot. He's going to be a full yard short. And I got to believe that they are going to let this final 23 seconds or so on that play clock tick off before they have Jack Knight punted away.
Justin Rand, once again, number 35, Mark, slipped through a block, got his right hand up and made the tackle. He has been explosive for the Broncos defense tonight.
So Jack Knight, he may let it roll all the way down. No, he's going to let it get down to 3 before he kicks it, and this is probably his best punt of the night, but it's going to give them an opportunity to return it, and a pretty decent return it'll be by Quentin Stephanie.
Well, great job by Stephanie, because you got to get out of bounds. You have to get out of bounds. You need to save time for your ball club. He was able to do that. In fact, he fought for it. He fought for the sideline. He found it, and the clock has stopped, and Jeff's in the driver's seat here.
You think they can go 74 yards in a minute 20, Mike?
No doubt about it. No doubt. Especially Grimes, his ability to throw the football deep and the receivers he has with Jenkins and Matthews.
Look at that rain come down. My goodness. They empty the backfield now. Keep an eye on that slot to the bottom of your screen, just off that left tackle. But they decide to go instead to Derek Matthews on the quick hitter. He runs it up for a gain of about 4 yards or so, it looks like.
Good coverage by Groover there to make sure the receiver stayed in bounds so the clock runs.
Yep, we're at a minute now. And again, almost not lost for Lafayette, Jeff. 14-point lead, but keep in mind, they get the ball back to start the second half. Pressure coming from Noblesville. Good job avoiding it by Grimes. And he finds a wide-open receiver who has plenty of room. And that is Munoz, who's done it all tonight.
And they're right on the ball once again. And the concern right now is Noblesville's being very soft defensively, rushing only three.
Now, he tried to down the football. He tried to spike it to stop the clock, and it slipped out of his hands before he did so. And I think after all is said and done, they may stick a 5-yard procedure penalty on Lafayette Jeff. But it looked to me like he took the snap quickly once everybody got set, and then he tried to spike the football and it slipped out of his hands. No whistle blew. So that's an illegal forward pass is what the call's going to be.
All right.
Which is an interesting call, we'll say. An interesting call.
There's no doubt about it. Don't see that very often.
Which I guess that would be the call, since it went to a receiver and there was no receiver in the area. Although I don't know. That's an interesting call. I mean, I would have thought that at the very least, Mike, that could have been ruled a fumble.
Yeah, exactly. It was a live ball behind the line of scrimmage. He dropped the ball on the ground and should have been ruled a fumble.
So a loss of five, and they throw it out to Munoz. He has a couple of blockers, and most importantly for Noblesville, he stays in bounds. Munoz might have been well advised to try to preserve a timeout by getting out of bounds instead of cutting it back inside.
Much like his teammate Matthews, get the football and go out of bounds. You don't have a lot of time to work with here in the second quarter, but for Jeff's sake, they did have a timeout. They were able to burn it and stop the clock.
And the clock continues to run. As we look up, we look at that clock, and that is, they do put the timeout, the length of the timeout up there. So
yeah,
the clock was stopped.
Clock stopped, and there's 39.8 seconds.
Yeah.
Yep, 39.8 left. And frankly, again, that's just too much time for Lafayette Jeff. Their offense can move the football and put up six. And they've been able to right now to kind of chunk at it a little bit at a time. They don't have to throw the ball deep right now. They still can go underneath the defense, get the ball out of bounds, and be in a good position to put 6 points on the board.
I have a sneaking suspicion about the only time they can't score is when it says 0-0-0 on the clock with the options they have at their disposal. But I'm just – how much work have they put in? You know, all throughout the off season and the summertime and in the fall to be able to run this hurry-up offense as efficiently as they do. And like I said, the linemen are what impressed me. And then, you know, the ability of their receivers to block is Jenkins is the beneficiary of that as he gets it just shy of the first down across the 40 to the 37. I mean, that's not a glamorous thing for a receiver to do, and some are reluctant to do it. Looked like the receiver to the bottom of the screen might have been lined up offsides. Noblesville with a little bit of pressure. Grimes directing traffic. Heaves it up in no man's land and just threw that ball away with 13 seconds left.
Well, the Noblesville defense found a way to stop the Jeff onslaught there and turn the ball over.
That's a big hold. But again, all is not lost for Jeff because, as we said, they get the ball to start the second half. I mean, they wanted points there most assuredly, but they know that when they come out for the second half, they'll get the ball back right away.
And they still maintain the momentum in this ball game, having scored the last touchdown. Now for Noblesville, did they just sit on it here with 13 seconds and end the quarter And Jeff is playing coverage all the way. They're playing way back off the line of scrimmage.
Drop the snap. Throws it out in the flat. And a penalty marker is down off the completion to Jaden Barrett. Procedure penalty against Noblesville. Probably an issue with who they did or did not have on the line of scrimmage. So a knee here would not be out of the question.
No.
Mike, especially with the issues that they've had snapping the football more often than not in this half. And I think you can look at that as an Achilles heel of Noblesville, clearly. I mean, they had one drive that was looking really good.
Yes.
And a bad snap set up a third down and long. They also had a holding penalty, I think, that put them in a bit of a hole. So I think Coach Roden can point to a couple of possessions in this first half that made a big, big difference for them offensively. And, again, those were unforced errors. On the carry, Blevins has some running room and is wrapped up and dropped across the 40.
One of the things we've seen, particularly in that play, was the speed of the Jeff linebackers. But Noblesville surprisingly calls timeout before the clock gets to zero.
It's, about 7/10 of a second, I think, is all left. So it's time for one more, I guess.
Well, if that's going to be the case, throw the ball into the end zone and see what happens. But frankly, the way that's raining out here, that's going to be difficult to do. So you got to be careful not to throw it away in the last play and have Jeff return it back for six.
Noblesville Millers, Mike, one of 15 IHSAA charter members. They have an enrollment of 2,882, 11th largest school in the state. We're a little surprised about that revelation that they're one of the original members. I think there are four or five schools on that list that are no longer in existence, but they are one of the originals of the IHSAA. And before this night's done, Mike, I'm going to tell you how they got the nickname Millers.
Mm-hmm.
So as they say, stay tuned for that, Mike. Pressure, Gremmel. He needs to get it away. Still scramble drill. Still a scramble drill. More pressure coming, and he's finally going to be wrapped up and dropped by Britton Chandler. We have waited a while to call his number, but called it when they needed it the most, and so that's going to take care of first half action. So a little bit of defensive momentum for Jeff as they head to the locker room with a 21-7 advantage. And they will have the football to start the second half as the rain continues to fall, but it's done nothing to dampen the offensive juggernaut that is Lafayette Jeff. Your score 21-7 at halftime.
Oh, that pass is deep and open, and it's going to be a touchdown.
Nice cut by Maxwell, getting behind a block. They're going to take it in.
He's got a man. He's wide open. Get it in free. He's going to be gone.
He already has one touchdown and 2 yards out.
That one is up 29.
He's going to cross the 40. He's got a man wide open across the 40. He is all alone, and he could take it all the way. Touchdown, Blue Devils.
65.
On the ISC Sports Network.
Mom, we're late, and I left my soccer bag at Cindy's, and I need to get my dress today.
It's okay, honey. I'll take care of it.
Oh, Mom, I'll take care of it.
We'll take care of it. With more ways to access Indiana's most highly skilled primary care doctors,
stop!
Indiana University Health makes it easy to take care of your family.
What? I told you I'd take care of it.
Schedule same-day primary care appointments at 1-888-IU-HEALTH.
We're shopping for new floor covering at Carpetland USA. You may think we're too little, but let's face it. We're a lot closer to the ground. We know floors. See what I mean? Carpetland USA has a ginormous selection. But most of all, we can count on these guys. Over 200 years of combined experience.
That's older than me!
Carpetland USA, State Road 20. Daily since 1969, Haley's Lock, Safe, and Key has provided expertise and solutions when dealing with residential or commercial security needs. Whether you're looking for a safe, seeking access solutions, or in need of automotive keys, nobody can serve you better than Haley's.
One-on-one service and simply the best solutions, we've been providing it daily for more than 40 years.
Haley's Lock Safe and Keys. Call, visit, or find us online. Two locations, Crawfordsville and Lafayette.
We have health coverage.
Not me.
Not having health insurance can be hard on your family's budget and prevent you from getting the care you need. Covering Kids and Families of Indiana has local licensed navigators committed to helping your family, kids, and adults get the right health care coverage. Our navigators will guide you through the steps at no cost. Make an appointment by visiting www.ckfindiana.org. Se habla español.
Tired of watching the same old things on TV? Something new is on the horizon. The ISC Sports Network. Contact your cable provider today to add the ISC Sports Network. See the big games, the big moments, the championships, and more from all across the state. High schools, colleges, original content you can't find anywhere else. On the ISC Sports Network, it's all here. Find out more information at iscsportsnetwork.com.
People always tell you what not to do. Don't hold your breath. Don't play with fire. Don't talk to strangers. Don't spend it all in one place. Find out what you can do. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise.
Power. We all want it. We all need it. It not only lights our homes, but it drives our businesses. It strengthens our communities. It empowers us to make our own decisions. Today, we're giving power to more than 22,000 members. We're a homegrown, locally based cooperative that does something the big electric companies won't: give safe, affordable, and reliable power to rural communities. We're Tipmont REMC, and our members have the power.
New. It's a sign of growth. A fresh start and full of possibilities. There's nothing like new. Introducing the new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. The brand new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, now open. Riverview.org.
I don't think of this as a high school weight room. It's more like a high school classroom. I'm learning how to manage my time here. I'm learning that it's important to have goals and that it takes persistence and commitment to reach them. And I'm learning that the best way to lead is by example.
Indiana High School Sports. They're more than just a game.
Come and see me play.
How can the Farmers Bank mobile app help you? You can transfer funds, check your account balances, make Farmers Bank loan payments, pay bills, check your account history, or locate our branches and ATMs, all from the convenient safety of your own smartphone. Our app features all these benefits, plus all the safety and security that you have grown to expect from the Farmers Bank. The Farmers Bank, your local bank, your mobile bank, your bank for life. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Was it 2001 the very first time you and I worked together, high school football for the Cathedral Irish, I think? Has it been that long, 2001?
2000.
2000, yeah. 2000. And we didn't, we didn't meet until right before the ball game.
That's right.
That's the first time we met.
How do you like that?
And we've not spoken since. Other than when we're on the air, because we really don't like each other. No, great to be back with you for sure. Mark James and Mike Walensky. A lot of water under the bridge since 2000 when we worked that ball. You still look the same. Me, I've aged horribly, Mike. But anyway, how about those Hardy fans? I mean, boy, I tell you, take your hats off to them. I mean, that's a dedicated bunch, and a nice crowd showed up given the conditions on both sides. And you know, Mike, the rain had let up a bit as we started to walk into the stadium. But, boy, right about the time it kicked off, and it has just been relentless. So much for those weather prognosticators that said it was going to let up this evening. It's not yet anyway. But it's done nothing, as we said, to dampen this impressive offensive and aerial display by Lafayette Jeff.
You would think that we'd have a lot of turnovers in this ball game with the slick surface. Now, we know that Noblesville's had some problems snapping the football under center, but for that matter, they've recovered most of those snaps. And for Jeff, they still keep throwing the football and making some great things happen. That puts a tremendous amount of pressure on the defense. It makes them run all over the football field, and eventually it could wear them out.
Let's not discount the impact that Marquise Munoz has had running the football for Lafayette, Jeff. Yeah. He's provided great balance tonight.
Yeah, he has. Munoz has done a really good job. And part of it is, you know, his extra desire to get extra yards, but also the fact, too, that as we talked about, the credit has to be given to Lafayette Jefferson and Broncos offensive line. They've done a really nice job of preparing. And take a look at Maximus Grimes. This young man, he's a player. He can really toss the football around.
So, Moquip Aquatic Fitness, an exercise program combining aquatics, athletics, and high-intensity interval training. It's a water workout your body will love for you. Grab your bogs and get wet. Sponsors of our halftime show. Let's take a look at Bruno's Big O's Sports Room. Halftime highlights, there are plenty of them, Mike Walensky, and most of them belong to Lafayette Jeff, although off the good return on the opening kickoff, they strike first, the Noblesville Millers and Jaden Barrett.
And Jaden Barrett gets his first touchdown pass of the season, but the Broncos come right back and moving this football downfield. Grimes down the field in the middle of the defense to number 10, Zion Austin, great pass play. And there, number two, Derek Matthews, who has 35 receptions here with 11 touchdowns. Another nice reception. Maximus Grimes has done a very good job throwing the ball both horizontally and vertically. You see nearly a pickoff there by Groover, number six, for the Noblesville Millers. And there was a fourth down conversion that just didn't happen as Munoz took his eye off the football. Maybe the one few glitch that the Broncos had offensively tonight, but boy, Grimes throwing deep downfield. And again, number five, his favorite target, Brian Jenkins, with his 16th. That's 16 touchdown reception of the season. Again, a bad snap, but again, the quarterback, Grant Gremmel, doing a really good job of recovering and moving the football downfield and running it. And he's had to carry the load for the most part, as you see another bad snap. It's just been one bad snap after another, and defensively, the Broncos have done a good job. That time was DeMarco Cross, number 82. DeMarco Cross, 82, and number 97, Peyton Price, been really good. But I think Justin Rand, the linebacker, number 35, he's been awfully good for the Broncos defensively.
Yep, Derek Matthews has been a guy that has played well for them tonight. He gets the football in his hands. A pretty good pedigree. You know, he's related to the Blackman family of basketball fame from Marion. He is a cousin, so a little bit of athletic ability. And he's a guy that his coaching staff, they kind of refer to him as a Swiss Army knife, if you will, Mike, a guy that can do a little bit of everything. And there you see a slot receiver, Zion Austin, who they've used effectively tonight as well.
Yeah, I've liked the way they've used Austin in this offense. Very difficult to pick him up out of the backfield. Grimes, just a two-step drop. Now, one of the things about Grimes that you look back in the film, the Noblesville coaching staff will say, we've got to find ways to put pressure on him. He's really good when he's able just to find his point in the backfield and step forward and throw the football. But as you mentioned, Munoz, what a horse.
Yeah, he's a guy that would probably be one of my first choices if I was choosing up sides, no question. We've seen him be effective. We saw the miscue where the ball bounced off of his face mask, but I think all in all, he's been awfully effective for them, and he's picked up the blitz a time or two. Nothing doing there as they had that screen pretty well defended. And, you know, Noblesville, let's face it, they've had their opportunities. You see their good, solid completions to them. And every time they start to move the chains forward, Mike, it seems like something causes things to come unraveled for them.
It's been a real challenge for the Millers here, but that short passing there, game has been defective. There's Blades making a really nice catch, getting his feet in bounds, and again, there it is, bad snap center.
Yeah, that kind of sums up the first half all in all, I think, for the Noblesville Millers, which has led to this 21-7 deficit for sure. And you're taking a look at Grimes' abilities to assess the defense, and a great adjustment there by Derek Matthews, which we mentioned, 750 receiving yards on the season for Derek Matthews, and he's been all over the field tonight, and just a good disciplined route, great pitch and catches. He beats Zach Groover in single coverage there, does Brian Jenkins to get touchdown number 16 on the season. And look at him, you know, extending plays, if you will, doing so to Munoz right there. So just a good half all in all for Lafayette Jeff. A family tradition since 1955, dine in or carry out daily at Bruno's. Come in and try our famous Bruno dog served with cheese or marinara sauce, located at 212 Brown Street in West Lafayette. Purdue fans, come check out Big O's Sports Room, filled with the best Boilermaker memorabilia. It's perfect for your pregame or postgame celebration. Again, your score at halftime, 21-7, Lafayette Jeff over Noblesville.
Boqua is athletics, aquatics, and exercise put together in a fun, effective package that allows you to get in great shape safely, effectively, with a bunch of friends.
It is a low-impact exercise. It's not hard on your joints.
It helps me with my balance. It helps me keep my muscles flexible.
If I could do it 5 nights a week, I probably would.
Oh, that pass is deep and open, and it's going to be a touchdown.
Nice cut by Maxwell, getting behind a block. They're going to take it in.
He's got a man. He's wide open. Getting it free. He's going to be gone.
Yard has one touchdown, 2 yards out.
That one is up 29.
He's going to cross the middle. He's got a man wide open across the 40. He is all alone, and he could take it all the way. Touchdown, Blue Devils.
65 on the ISC Sports Network.
At Mulberry Health, we know recovering from a surgery or serious illness requires extra care. We'll help you reclaim your health and strength, just like Sue, who was told she might not walk again.
They have been so helpful. The people here have given me hope that I will walk.
Our team will work with you and your doctor to make a plan so you can return home as quickly and safely as possible. We work with most insurance providers, and with a Medicare Advantage plan, you may not require a 3-day stay for coverage. Come meet us, and we'll show you how we encourage our residents to live a full, rich, meaningful life.
The only way to get better is to challenge yourself. And that's what we're doing at Xfinity. We are challenging ourselves to improve every aspect of your experience. And this includes our commitment to being on time, every time. That's why if we're ever late for an appointment, we'll credit your account $20. It's our promise to you. We're doing everything we can to give you the best experience possible. Because we should fit into your life, not the other way around.
Applying for healthcare coverage can be hard. Let us help.
Covering kids and families of Indiana's local licensed navigators provide free assistance to kids and adults.
Go to www.ckfindiana.org. Click on your county. Schedule an appointment.
For more information, please give us a call at the number listed below.
Se habla español.
Every business we work with at Haley's has different security needs. As a certified Medico Security Center, we provide the highest quality products with affordable solutions for your business. E-cylinders fit into your existing hardware and are controlled from your computer. Medico Smart Solutions provide options for different employee access levels, patented key control, loss and liability protection. Surveillance cameras protect your employees and your business. Call today for your free business security assessment. Let the professionals at Haley's keep your business safe with locations in Lafayette and Crawfordsville.
People always tell you what not to do. Don't get your clothes dirty. Don't bite off more than you can chew. Don't cross the line. Don't make faces. Find out what you can do. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise.
Tired of watching the same old things on TV? Something new is on the horizon. The ISC Sports Network. Contact your cable provider today to add the ISC Sports Network.
See the big games, the big moments, the championships, and more from all across the state. High schools, colleges, original content you can't find anywhere else. On the ISC Sports Network, it's all here. Find out more information at iscsportsnetwork.com.
Power. We all want it. We all need it. It not only lights our homes, but it drives our businesses. It strengthens our communities. It empowers us to make our own decisions. Today, we're giving power to more than 22,000 members. We're a homegrown, locally based cooperative that does something the big electric companies won't: give safe, affordable, and reliable power to rural communities. We're Tipmont REMC, and our members have the power.
Mom, we're late, and I left my soccer bag at Cindy's, and I need to get my dress today.
It's okay, honey. I'll take care of it.
Oh, Mom, I'll take care of it.
We'll take care of it. With more ways to access Indiana's most highly skilled primary care doctors, Indiana University Health makes it easy to take care of your family.
What? I told you I'd take care of it.
Schedule same-day primary care appointments at 1-888-IU-HEALTH.
We're shopping for new floor covering at Carpetland USA. You may think we're too little, but let's face it, we're a lot closer to the ground. We know floors. See what I mean? Carpetland USA has a ginormous selection. But most of all, we can count on these guys. Over 200 years of combined experience.
That's older than me!
Carpetland USA, State Road 26.
So, Mike, the Miller mascot was adopted in 1925. C.B. Jenkins, the manager of the Milling Company, offered to buy new uniforms if Miller's was put on them. That practice was common statewide at the time, by the way. Up until that time, Noblesville was known simply as the Black and Gold. So that's how they became the Noblesville Millers.
And they're very interesting high school from the standpoint that with the school colors of black and gold, the school fight song is the Indiana University fight song.
That is interesting. Maybe more so than the fact that now they became to be known as the Millers. Health and Communities offers free monthly health screenings throughout Clinton County. These screenings are free and open to all. For locations and more information, visit healthyclintoncounty.org. The rain continues to fall as teams report to the respective sidelines, and we get ready for second half. So, Mike Walensky, take us into the Noblesville locker room. If you're Justin Roden, you told your ball club what in terms of how to attack the second half?
Well, they've got to be more aggressive defensively. They have to control the line of scrimmage somehow. They can't do it with three down linemen. There's no doubt about that. There's got to be some linebackers. 2A is one player that can make a difference, and for whatever reason, as the game progressed, Jeff took him out of the game. And when Jeff was able to throw the football, they gave their quarterback plenty of time. Noblesville has to take some risks. They have to take some risks. They have to get after the line of scrimmage, whether it's the run game or the passing game, and they have to create some turnovers and get some short fields. If they can do that, get a quick touchdown, get back in the ball game, it'll be important. But just as a first half mark, it'll be important for a quick start. Whoever gets the quick start in this case, Lafayette Jeff ultimately had the quicker start. They're in the driver's seat.
Number half of this bracket features Carmel hosting Westfield tonight. Some other games of note: Warren Central, Ben Davis, Lawrence North, and Lawrence Central. Center Grove taking on Columbus North. Kokomo at McCutcheon tonight. Cathedral at home with Roncalli. Terre Haute North and South and Vigo County doing battle. Delta at home tonight. Mount Vernon at Greenwood and the Mooresville Pioneers at Richmond. Also Evansville Central at Northview. Those are just some of the games on the card tonight. This kickoff return to the 20. A little bit of a seam for Brian Jenkins. Slips out of one would-be tackle before he says, I'm out of here at the 24-yard line.
Brian Jenkins, a nice return because he didn't have much. He just veered towards that right sideline and got himself a couple extra yards. And speaking of tournament play in the area, Kokomo leads McCutcheon at halftime 12-7. New Pal leads Zionsville 16-7 at half. That West Warren Central Ben Davis game, the Warriors lead at halftime 28-21. Bishop Chatard in Class 3A way out in front of Rushville 49-6 in the third. And Cathedral leads Roncalli 13-10 at halftime. Some scores around the area.
And a bunch formation to the top. Instead, they come to Jenkins to the bottom and let him work one-on-one. Pretty good pressure defensively. Pretty good coverage all in all. Noblesville, Carson Sanders stepped up out of his defensive back position to limit the advantage to a couple, and a penalty marker is down. And we've got an ineligible downfield, I believe, against Lafayette Jeff.
And that'll be a big plus for Noblesville because the Broncos have been
wave
it off. How do you like that? The Broncos have been very efficient on first down, and that time they did get 2 or 3 yards. They have not had any negative plays here in the first half, and if they can move the chains here, they are in the driver's seat for good in this one.
Well, give them 5, so 2nd and 5 now is back to a bit more of a traditional offensive set, and that was almost picked off. Carson Sanders was there, and it slipped right through the wickets, and the intended target was Brian Jenkins, making it a 3rd and 5, and a huge defensive down for Noblesville.
And that time, the Millers had 4 guys rushing the quarterback. They've dropped down an extra linebacker, showing a little bit of pressure here.
Watch Zion Austin in the slot to the right. They release him out of the backfield when the pressure comes. Instead, he's there as a lead blocker, and they give it to Munoz, and they stop him. That's an interesting call.
Dalton Davis.
Interesting call.
Ran into a wall there, Mark.
No kidding. I mean, how about Zach Knoll and Tolliver and Jenkins and company up front? My goodness. Ham was there, 2A. I mean, gosh. Let's not forget that penalty, Mike. Those things, you know, they just have a way of stalling drives, even for the best of them. So Jenkins will punt it away. He averages 33 yards.
Whoa!
His long 58, and it's a snap over his head. He chases it down, and now they got to get the angle on him, and they do. Good pursuit there, and they wrap him up at about the 10-yard line. So a huge break. Special teams defense doing the job for Noblesville after their kickoff return team did the job to start the first half.
Well, that's what you need. You needed their defense to tighten up, control the line of scrimmage. They did that, and then they get what turns out to be as close to a turnover as you can have here, and they are knocking on the door now.
First and goal from about the 8-yard line. Tuaday was the guy to gobble him up and drop him. So a huge break for Noblesville. Let's see if they capitalize here. Blevins in the backfield along with Hillman. Hillman just to the right of his quarterback. Blevins is the deep back, and they'll go that way with the lead blocker and nothing doing.
Wow.
That road was emphatically closed. 45, Britton Chandler came up from his middle linebacker position and said, not tonight.
They had an extra blocker on the right side, but they went over the left side. And
just, I mean, that's
bam.
Just the getting off the line of scrimmage and moving, guys. That's all you're doing there as a defensive lineman. I mean, that's great form. You got to get lower than the lowest, and that's what they did there. Similar formation now. Two tight end. Bad snap, he gobbles it up, single coverage out the flat, nothing doing there. Gruber was trying to run off the defender, and he was able to get a little room there, but Gremmel did not make a good throw. Noblesville needs to capitalize here, Mike, 3rd and goal.
Makes it a challenge, and at times, looking at Noblesville tape, they like to go to Blevins out of the backfield, number 7. Offensive line needs to do a good job of holding up this Jeff defense because they're going to be really coming after things right now.
Third down and goal for the Millers. A slot released up the seam, but they'll go to the end zone and got the defender turned around behind him, bobbled it a couple of times, and Kruger hauls it in for the touchdown. Nothing's been easy for Noblesville tonight.
Wow. That's a huge play for the Millers. It gets them right back in the ball game. Good play action there by Gremmel.
That's a great throw and a good job of getting that defender turned around. Defender just lost touch of him.
He did.
Noblesville not going away, which is not a surprise to anyone who's familiar with any team coached by Justin Roden. boy, if you're Jeff, you think, you know, and now you're called for offsides. But I mean, if you're Jeff, you've got the ball to start the second half. Yeah. You got a 14-point lead, and boy, you're thinking a good drive, good quick score, put this thing away early, and next thing you know, you get a stop off a penalty. Little miscue on the punt, give Noblesville good field position. But, Mike, let's not underscore the importance of that third down conversion there, something that they've not had a lot of success with in the ball game tonight, talking about Noblesville.
Yeah. They were able to finally finish and put the ball in the end zone. And, in fact, in this ball game, you could make the argument they have been their own worst enemy.
Connor Gutting to hold cleverly with the snap, and that's Jack Knight to attempt the point after, and yet another flag down, and again, it looks as though Lafayette Jeff has lined up in the neutral zone.
It was number 19 jumping offside Monroe for the Broncos. Really doesn't make any sense to go for two at this point.
No, I agree. So Jack Knight hopefully gets the chance to kick the extra point, and he does, and he drills it. And how about this? With 10 minutes to go in the third quarter, we're at 21-14. Jeff gave him a little bit of an opening there, Mike, and they certainly took advantage of it. Here's a fun fact. Did you know that Mayor Ditzler often says goodbye with be cool and stay true to your school? Go Millers. Thanks to Noblesville for supporting their football program tonight here as they travel over to Lafayette Jeff. That's huge for Justin Roden and his ball club to start this half.
No doubt about it. It keeps them in the ball game. It gives them that glimmer of hope and that momentum that they needed, that they wanted to have deep in the second period that they couldn't convert, and gave the football back to Jeff. Now the Broncos missed an opportunity in the last minute to put points on the board in their right.
So, Derek Matthews among those dropping deep to receive. Always dangerous Brian Jenkins is back there as well. And Mr. Do-Everything when it comes to special teams, Jack Knight is set to kick it away for the Noblesville Millers. Great start to the second half at Noblesville. And that's doing what you need to do. When they make those rare miscues, you take advantage of them. Ball's going to roll out of bounds. And, boy, that's a heads-up play by Brian Jenkins. He almost stepped up and fielded that ball, but realized the angle that it was taking. And rather than risk the return and fumbling around with the football, he's going to give his team good field position at 35.
Yeah. And, you know, as much as you invest money in the fundamentals of coaching kids in the offensive, defensive line, skill position, you have to have a really good special teams unit. That is just an absolute weapon when you get into tournament play, because field position is really critical. And now Noblesville, with momentum, has a chance to get back in the ball game.
Let's see if their defense stiffens here. Tall task against Maximus Grimes, and I continue to watch Zion Austin, who's a slot receiver this time to the left. They're going to run the football with Munoz, and Noblesville has appeared to have made a bit of an adjustment in terms of how they're attacking and running the football up front as Zach Gruber steps up to make the stop, and here they go in hurry-up mode again. Three receivers to the top of the screen. Grimes is looking that way. Here comes the screen, and it's incomplete. And, you know, you got to give a lot of credit to Wyatt Blades. He came up from his free safety position, and I think they heard footsteps. And so now you're looking at a third and six.
That was a big play. And, again, the momentum is starting to shift here. If Noblesville can make a play right now and force the Broncos to punt, they're back in the ball game and back in business, just a score part.
They'll run the option. Noblesville defends it pretty well, and I think Munoz stepped out of bounds and might have done so before he got to the first down marker, and that is the case. He steps out at about the 43-yard line. I got to think that Pat Shanley is going to go for it here on fourth and about two.
Well, Sanders came up with a huge play there. Number nine, the outside corner there for the Noblesville Millers, had his left hand on the runner's leg and knocked him down, but you're right. Looks like he's going to spin the dice and go for the first down here.
And they'll empty out the backfield in doing so, needing 2 yards. Three receivers dispatched to the top of the screen, two to the bottom. They'll throw it underneath,
great
and a
hands.
Great throw and catch by
wow.
Brian Jenkins. He had to elevate to get that. Not bad defense at all
not
by
all.
Zach Gruber. He's just going against one of the best receivers in the state.
Jenkins just showed marvelous hands there, Mark. Just a great job by Jenkins to keep the ball game rolling for the Broncos.
A bunch of receivers to the right and to the left. Screen comes this way, and what a great job of defending that by Noblesville. Coming up and blowing it up is Wyatt Blades.
Yeah, Blades was so quick there. The official on the far side was just about ready to pull out his hanky and chose not to do it. To credit to this young man for making the play on number seven, Bishop Johnson.
Matthews and Munoz have been really active tonight, but there's no doubt Brian Jenkins is the real deal as a wideout for Lafayette, Jeff. At 6'2", ideal size, as we mentioned, almost 900 yards receiving, averages about 18 yards a catch. Quarterback draw by Grimes. He has some running room before he's wrapped up and dropped just shy of the first down.
Wow.
Looks like they'll put him down at about the 42.
He's going to go for another 20 yards if Zenick doesn't get over there, the linebacker. Zenick did a great job, number 10. For Noblesville, picking up Grimes.
Trips to the bottom of the screen. Looks like they're going to give Munoz a carry, and he's going to have the first down and more across the 35.
The Broncos running against that three-man front off the left side there, and Munoz doing a great job once again finding the first down.
Leach and Zenick in on the stop, so on first and 10. Pressure coming. They get pressure on him. He's able to slip away from it. Grimes looking underneath and throws it away. Wanted to go to Derek Matthews, but I think he was more interested in just getting rid of the football.
Yeah, that's a smart job for this young man who's only thrown 5 interceptions. And you see his football IQ is starting to ramp up there, because otherwise he could have very easily thrown that football into coverage.
Averages 300 yards a game. Receivers are averaging 18 yards a catch, 42 touchdowns, and as Mike mentioned, just 5 interceptions. And oh, by the way, again, he's a sophomore. Going for it all here. Pretty good defense, had to help over the top and underneath, most notably Zach Gruber. And Gruber's a very active defensive player, but Aiden Richardson was helping him there in double coverage.
That time, Noblesville had 4 guys rushing the passer, and the left defensive end for the Millers did a good job of sort of hurrying at the last moment, getting his arms up, and Grimes had to throw the football a little bit deep there.
Big third down and 10 now. Grimes, Munoz to his right. Munoz steps up, blocks the defensive end. They throw it underneath, wow. And the pass is complete to Zion Austin. We thought we would see him eventually, and he just leaked out the flat from that slot position at the bottom of the formation. And as we mentioned, a guy with 400 yards and 20 catches on the season.
Great job of throwing the football. Just a nice touch there. He's not trying to overthrow the football, trying to drive the ball to the outside of the receiver. Did a good job.
Yeah, Blades thought he had a shot at it. Then they go to Munoz on first down, and he is wrestled down with authority by Eddie Zenick.
Yeah, and Zenick really wrapped him hard enough where the Broncos offensive lineman thought there should have been an unsportsmanlike conduct called. And you can take a look at Munoz. He's shirt.
He's limping off the field, and that's a noticeable limp, and that is not good news for the offensive fortunes of Lafayette, Jeff. Look at that formation to the high side. They've got 4 receivers bunched up there. Instead, they're looking first at single coverage. Pressure coming. Grimes runs away from it, and he's chased out of bounds. They did a nice job of defending that 4 receiver set to the high side and gave him nowhere to go in single coverage to the bottom.
Well, this young man, Grimes, he really has a good idea of what he needs to do with the football.
Now, he's a sophomore in grade only, don't you think? I mean, really,
no doubt.
At this point?
He looks like he's a senior ready to play next week at the next level.
Yeah, and Coach Shanley said they've thrown a lot at him, and he just takes it in like a sponge. Noblesville doing a great job of blowing up that screen And Wyatt Blades continues to be very active. Although Blades, Mike, he had, 60 tackles coming into play, and including a 4 tackles for loss out of a defensive back position.
Yeah, they have been really active defensively on the outside there. But again, good Grimes, a lot of credit for delivering the football. He's not made any critical mistakes right now in the ball game.
Yeah, they've essentially taken away that quick screen with that bunch formation. Grimes, pressure coming, but only 4.
Wow.
Wide open in the slot was Zion Austin for the touchdown. And Mike, in that situation, bottom line is this: Noblesville simply has to find a way to get pressure on the quarterback, because Maximus Grimes will sit back there and do just that. He'll pick you apart like a surgeon.
Yeah, he's got a great window there to deliver the ball right down the middle of the field. A lot of times, if you got a defensive lineman who, get their hands up in the air, the quarterback doesn't have very much of a window to throw, but not that time. It appeared, though, that one of the Noblesville Miller linemen was converging, but he was turned away at the last minute. What a great job by this youngster.
A touchdown pass on 4th and 9, and the ball is down. The kick is up, and it is good. So just when it looked like Noblesville was going to shut the door, not to be denied, as Max Grimes just broke the school record for touchdown passes in a season. And again, he's got an opportunity to break his own record, at least 2 more anyway, with him just being a sophomore.
I think it's remarkable, Mark. What's remarkable is not the number, it's just how he's improved, because I watched him play in the opener against West Lafayette. He had some mechanics issues, and that has been changed dramatically, to a point now where he can go with the deep ball. He can toss the ball anywhere he wants.
Well, Pat Chanley said that the thing you got to like about him is he puts in the time, for sure. And he has put in the time. And in case you missed it earlier, he as soon as basketball season was over, starting point guard on the basketball team, he got together with the receivers on his own, and they worked out regularly on their own. And Coach Chanley said he organized it, Grimes did, and that he got Jenkins to go on spring break with him, and those two really didn't know each other well. And then, they did all the 7-on-7 stuff and spent all the time together in the summer. And I think it's paid huge dividends for this ball club throughout the season.
It's just been outstanding for this ball club, because you can tell that his whole unit is energized. He's probably made everybody better, including that offensive line, who's done a pretty good job protecting him. That they're protecting him because they respect him. There's no question about it.
No reason for Noblesville to push the panic button here if they get an opportunity for a return. Hopefully they'll be able to glean good field position out of it. And it looks like they're going to be able to do just that. How about this return by Zenick? He rumbles and stumbles inside the 45 to the 40-yard line. That is a load that you're going to try to bring down at 5'10 and 200 pounds.
And you got to give him a lot of credit, because on a kickoff like that, he has every reason to put up his hand for a fair catch. Instead, he said, I'm going to take this ball, and I'm going to make something happen. And look at this. The Millers have the ball in the 40.
Riverview Health Westfield Hospital is now open, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. To learn more, visit riverview.org. No question, special teams, they've taken advantage of some opportunities here tonight, have the Noblesville Millers with their special teams.
It's kept them in the ball game. The turnover off the punt, Braden's kickoff return, that kickoff return by Zinnick. But the defense has been really good, except for that tackling right there.
How about that run?
Wow.
You hit him as hard as you want, but you got to wrap him up and bring him down for sure. Luke Blevins keeps the legs driving. A good second effort results in a positive gain, and one that looked like it was going to be bottled up and goes nowhere, eventually ends up going for 9 yards.
Wow. 45 Chandler had a shot, but frankly, the Noblesville offensive line kept it alive, because they still had a body on Chandler as well as Cross 82.
2nd and 1. That opens the playbook nice and wide, but they're going to give it to Zinnick again. He gets the corner, and look at this run down inside the 15 to about the 11-yard line.
Some combo blocking inside, some double teams by the offensive line for Noblesville. Open up on the right side there, and a nice run and a first down for the Millers. And they're back in business again.
Usually the grounded, pounded guy, as we said, Mike, known more as a defender, but 31 carries, 170 yards, and 2 touchdowns on the season. But he's been pretty active on both sides of the football tonight.
Great blocking there by 31, Max Pollard.
Ground ball. He's able to gather it back in. He's got a receiver in single coverage, and he completes it for the touchdown. Great throw and catch to Zach Gruner. You can't throw it and catch it any better than that.
Same pass play to Groover in the corner of the end zone, and another touchdown. A great catch there. His third touchdown of the season, just his eighth catch of the year. They're making it happen here at Noblesville, and they're making this close.
Quentin Stephanie, the guy that was beaten there. And that is a tough, tough ball to defend. You can't throw it any better than that. He just dropped it right down the drain pipe, as they say, Mike.
Yep.
So Jack Knight trying to put the exclamation point on the Noblesville answer and keep this one close. Ball is down, kick is up, and it is good. And how about that? Special teams continue to pay dividends for the Noblesville Millers as they pulled within seven now with 5:39 to play. And this has been, despite the conditions, Mike, a very entertaining football game.
Wow, it's been rock'em sock'em here. To Noblesville's credit, they've been able to finish and get on the scoreboard and make this interesting at 28-21. We still have got a lot of time to play here in the third and a quarter ahead of us. So we've got ourselves a battle brewing here at Schumann Stadium in Lafayette.
Is there a better time of the year, Mike?
There's no better time of the year. And interestingly enough, because it's been so warm, the leaves are still on the trees. Generally, when the leaves start falling, it's an indication that the IHSA football tournament is underway, but not this year. The leaves are still on the trees, and the change of color is going to take a little bit longer than normal.
Let's give a lot of credit to the late Bob Springer, longtime legendary coach at Indianapolis Washington High School when he headed up the Indiana Football Coaches Association. He was the one that essentially put pen to paper and drew up the idea that every team goes to the postseason. I work for his son, Mike, who's the principal at Monrovia High School, and Coach Springer, but watching from above, congratulations, and I hope you're proud of what you got started here in the state of Indiana, because I think it's the best football tournament at the high school level in the country.
Well, it's exceptional, and a program like Noblesville starting to come on here tonight at 4-5 has a chance.
It's a pretty good kick. It drives him back to the goal line. And on the return is Bishop Johnson, and he's got some running room up the left side. They finally chase him out of bounds near the midfield stripe, and there to do so is Aiden Richardson. So a big answer, but a penalty marker is down, and that's usually bad news for the return team. They actually kicked that flag back a little farther to about the 32-yard line. You know, Mike, there are those that say, you know, they wish the 6A boundary was maybe north and south instead of east and west because of some perceive in central Indiana as the advantage that gives Carmel. Some have suggested seating, which I think is close to an impossible proposition to be able to pull off. There are those that disagree with that, and that's fine. But, you always look at tweaks here and there, but I think all in all, as I said, this is a really good tournament. The one big adjustment that I think they made that I agree the most with is putting essentially the bye week for 6A in the first round of the sectional instead of the semi-state weekend as it was, I believe, the first year.
Yeah, I think it's a good move. I think this is a tournament that eventually the cream rises. It really doesn't matter who you play.
From the 22, an incomplete pass. Go ahead.
Whoever wins the championship at any level, whether it's Class A or 6A, Class A, Pioneer being the favorite, 6A, Warren Central being the favorite this year, they're going to earn it. You have to earn it. And tonight, Lafayette Jeff is being pushed to the limit here.
Second down and 10. Noblesville showing a little bit of pressure.
Thomas Hogan on the carry.
And as we mentioned, the carry, Thomas Hogan, the sophomore who's into the ball game for Munoz, who was injured on the last series, limped off the field and didn't look like that we would see him again. Maybe we will. We'll see.
Yeah, he just
came on
the
field.
He
just went back into the ball game. Okay,
so that's a plus for Jeff, as Hogan has 455 yards this year. But Munoz there, he's been big. But boy, what a nice job defensively on the right side by the Noblesville Millers. I tell you, number 42 Jenkins, Kenjin Jenkins, number 42. He's been really good.
On a third down and 5, he's going to come up short, not going to get anything on the carry. As you mentioned, Jenkins among those in on the stop.
Got some help, too, from Groover, number six, who's been good making those two touchdown catches. But defending passes, defending in space, he's been pretty good.
We'll see if Brian Jenkins gets a clean snap. This got them in trouble last time. They were punting in just about the same area. He gathers it in, punts it upfield, and this one it looks like is going to be returnable. Groover has some running room, gets a block, gets wrapped up and dropped, and a good return across the 50 to about the 47. So good field position for Noblesville with 4 minutes to play in the quarter and a 7-point deficit.
So far, Noblesville has been winning the battle special teams. There's no doubt about that. And Groover showed great hands there. That punt was up in the air about shoulder pads high, and he grabbed the football with authority and just took off and ran the football and got himself a nice return. And the Millers are in plus field position right now. And that is going to give a lot of confidence to that offensive line who's been banged up the entire season.
I really like the adjustments that Noblesville made defensively in this half, Mike. I mean, they've been awfully stingy. They they've started to bring a little bit of pressure. You know, they scored on that 4th and 9, and we mentioned then it was about time for them to think about making some adjustments and bringing some pressure, and almost on cue they started to do just that. The carry for Noblesville, the pile moves forward for a gain of about 2.
McLevin's 538 yards coming into the ball game. Averaging nearly 5 yards a carry, he's pretty good. But I tell you what, that Jeff defense comes attacking at you, and they really make it difficult to get some positive yards here.
I like Zenick back there. We mentioned his efforts as a linebacker, and there he is on the carry. He gets a block from Blevins. But, you know, Blevins got to the point of impact, Mike, and then he just stopped. He engaged the defender, and he stopped. And I think coaches would, by and large, like to see him engage that defender and work through that block and keep driving him upfield. You might be able to squeeze another yard or two out of it. And an illegal chop block is called against Noblesville, and that is a huge penalty.
Yeah, those are the kinds of penalties that have cost this ball club throughout the course of the year. And that's going to put them way, way behind the chains here.
Well, we have mentioned, Mike, that, bottom line, you know, while they have taken advantage of a couple of Lafayette Jeff miscues, there's no question Noblesville has certainly shot themselves in the foot more than once here tonight.
Yep. And yet, with 3 minutes and 18 seconds to go and running in this third period, they are still in the ball game.
15-yard penalty, second and long. The 17-yard penalty all in all brings up a second and 23. You just want to get part of that here. You don't need to get it all, but they're going for a big play. They throw into double coverage, and actually I think he saw Groover was covered, Mike, so a pretty good decision on his part to simply throw it away. But give credit to the secondary for Lafayette. Jeff did a great job of covering downfield.
Yeah, they gave him a different look there. Number 19, Monroe, started out as outside linebacker, then dropped into coverage, and literally Groover was triple team. There's no way to throw that football into that short window.
We haven't called Chandler's number a lot tonight, but he's been pretty disruptive. I mean, he's forced some guys to pick him up when he's blitzed. As we mentioned, combined 86 tackles on the season, including 10 tackles for loss. And then they go on the little delayed draw to Lance Blevins, and Blevins gets respectable yardage across the 45 to about the 47-yard line, but going to bring up a fourth down and long. And as the clock rolls toward the 2.5-minute mark, they're going to punt it away.
Well, you mentioned Chandler, 45. He's coming off the field gingerly right now. He may have tweaked something. I'm not quite sure what that is as he's heading towards the bench. But a good job of Lafayette Jeff keeping the ball inside the tackles.
Jack Knight to kick it away. Skips a couple. Kicks it away toward the left hash mark. It's going to get on the ground, take a pretty decent bounce. But Quentin Stephanie is going to make the return. And as he gets to the 20, we see the laundry fly.
Mm-mm-mm.
And we'll see what that penalty is and who it benefits. Boy, we have had two different halves of football here, have we not?
We certainly have, and this series upcoming Could be a real challenge for the Broncos. Starting off, it appears to be deep in their own zone.
Yep, that's the you see the call there on the illegal block is going to go against them, and that's going to back them up and help Noblesville flip the field position if they could stiffen up defensively. But, you know, if you're Justin Roden, Mike, that chop block penalty really stalled that drive. And you have to maximize your possessions if you're Noblesville, because this offense, so many weapons and the ability to strike so very quickly. And just when you think you might be gaining some momentum against them, along comes a big play. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, all the different formations they throw at you, you know, a bunch trips to the top and bunch trips to the bottom, four-receiver bunch formations. And it's amazing to me the efficiency with which they're able to run this offense. And they run the jet sweep to Brian Jenkins, and what a great run by him, plus 13 up the left side to about the 22.
Noblesville, one adjustment they made is Dalton Davis, number 56, is now in a defensive tackle. But you see number 5, Brian Jenkins, just get out there and show some great speed.
And again, credit the secondary for Noblesville, because, Mike, those screens just aren't clean.
Not tonight.
They're not getting good looks. I mean, Justin Johnson sparks out there to disrupt it. Zach Tuane is out there to bust it up. And they really defended that well tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Trips to the bottom, little quarterback draw, and a great defensive play by the Noblesville Millers. Skyler Tolliver, that's his fourth tackle for loss on the season.
Good job by Tolliver, and Zenick in the middle was blitzing. They had 5 guys in there, and you see Tolliver, 55, come on and converge to make the tackle, and that's a big play. It forces a huge third down now for the Broncos.
Couple of sacks and 6 hurries on the season for Tolliver. On 3rd and 13, Grimes is trying to keep that drive alive. He's looking right where he has trips. Deep ball, has a man open, and he missed Brian Jenkins by about a step and a half.
Boy, he had him. He was there. He had a beat on the defender there, number 2 for Noblesville. He had him beat by a couple steps, and Jenkins just couldn't keep up with it. But that's a big play by the Millers to turn this around and now maybe get the ball back in great field position.
Well, I think if you're Justin Roden, you got to be awfully pleased so far with the adjustments that your ball club has made defensively in the second half. And, you know, they've taken advantage of some opportunities and really slowed down this very impressive offense of Lafayette Jeff.
And Jeff has to be very careful here. Have need a good snap. Wow.
It was a low snap, but that is a great kick. Mm-hmm. It's going to hit the ground at about the 35, wow. And what an awesome punt. Look at that wow. thing continue to roll on that turf, and it's going to roll dead at about the 15-yard line. My goodness.
Mm.
That changes things.
Started on their own 19 and all the way down the other end. How do you like that?
That's going to help Brian. His long was 58. I think he's beaten that. That's going to help that 33-yard average too. So, I mean, that's a guy that he just so very many things. Well, I like that jet sweep. It's the first time we've seen that tonight to start that series for him. As we said, 48 catches, 850 yards, 15 touchdowns. Averages 18 yards a reception. And think about that now. 48 receptions, and he averages 18 yards a catch.
You know, just shows that skill level, that speed, that awareness of being able to find the open hole, the run after catch. It's just an added weapon for this Lafayette Jeff ball club. But now, you know, defensively, they still have to make plays here.
Pass out to flat. Receiver is open. It is complete. Wyatt Blades, we called him a lot out of the secondary defensively in that first half, and now he gets into the act offensively.
They've got a lot of guys playing both ways there. Davis, the center, playing nose tackle as well. And Blades, as you mentioned. And, of course, Zenick, the linebacker, also running the ball and blocking.
Garrett Price stepped up out of his cornerback position to try to make that stop, and he just kind of, you know, flicked him off like a little bug and got about 5 more out of it. From the 33, Noblesville Throws it out the flat. Good throw and catch, and really good defense by Lafayette Jeff. Steven Stephanie stepping up to make that stop.
Barrett gets his 15th catch of the season. As you mentioned, Stephanie did a good job, but Groover was coming over on a crossing route, as you see a flag on the play.
Yeah, flag on the high side at the top of the screen.
Could be another hold on the Millers.
Yeah, illegal procedure, which is better news than a hold,
yep,
for sure.
Yep.
Is it just me, or does it seem like this third quarter has lasted a week and a half? It's a pretty good throw and catch, but again, all for naught. It's a false start. Lafayette Jeff leads it by 7. We get ready to wrap up period number 3, sectional 4. 6A with the first week off, and they're full bore now. Looking right, looking left, plenty of time to throw. And he's got to throw it away.
He's got to throw it away.
And he's hearing about it from the sidelines too. I mean, that is a mistake that you do not expect a senior to make.
You can't take that loss.
No,
not this stage of the game, and not this down and distance. This forces him third and boy, forever.
I mean, you're outside the tackle box. Just throw it into the stands. You know, it's 2nd and 22. That changes things a bit. And we'll see if Lafayette Jeff can capitalize now. Spread that defense out a little bit as a result. Look how deep those linebackers are playing. Gremmel tries to set up the screen. It's defended very, very well, but still manages to break a tackle and squeeze a yard or two out of it. But Lafayette Jeff was not biting on the screen to the tight end Luke Williams.
Cross missed a tackle in the backfield there, and Price came in and cleaned it up. And I think, Mark, right now, I think the Lafayette Jeff defense is kind of tired. They're not putting the kind of pressure at the line of scrimmage that they were early on in the ball game, or at least through the early part of the third period.
DeMarco Cross, he defended that screen very, very well, as he does most things defensively. But Noblesville, they'll have a 3rd and 24 when they come back. They trail Lafayette Jeff by 7. Defense has stepped it up. We'll see if the Jeff offense could get back on track when we come back for fourth quarter action.
Keep up to date with your favorite high school, college, and semi-professional teams on the ISC Sports app. Download it today from the App Store, Google Play, or on Roku. The ISC Sports Network. Local lives here.
We chose Haley's for our video surveillance needs because we've had great luck with them on the lock, safe, and key side. And when we found out that they also do video surveillance, we right away knew that we could trust Rick and his team over there. I would definitely recommend Haley's Lock, Safe, and Key to any business owner. They take great care of you. They have good, fair prices, and service after the sale is tremendous.
For security solutions and unbeatable support after the sale, visit Haley's in Lafayette and Crawfordsville.
We love to see you here at the Farmers Bank. However, we know there are times you need to bank on your schedule, wherever you may be. With the Farmers Bank mobile banking app, you can check balances, transfer funds, pay bills, and now you can also securely deposit checks with your smartphone by simply taking a picture of the check. Download our mobile banking app today. The Farmers Bank, your local bank, your mobile bank, your bank for life.
Welcome back, Mark James, Mike Walensky. Set for fourth quarter action now. Jeff, Noblesville, pretty good one. Second half's been really good. 3rd and 24 now. What the Millers face, just trying to maybe get themselves in good field position from a punting standpoint, but pressure. And guess who? DeMarco Cross at 6'4", 206, and a junior. That's 9 tackles for loss coming into the season to go along with 9 hurries and 46 tackles. Let's face it, with that length and that speed, he creates matchup problems for most left tackles.
He did, and Monroe, number 19, also did a good job of breaking down the pocket for for Noblesville. Didn't give Gremmel much of an opportunity to throw the football.
Jeff tried to flip the field here, and Jack Knight punts it away. That one gets on the ground, and it's going to take a pretty good Noblesville roll. Not as fortuitous as the roll that Lafayette Jeff got on their last punting opportunity. But nonetheless, it rolls inside the 35 to about the 34-yard line. Our goal is to make life as full, rich, and meaningful as possible for you and your family. Call us today, 765-296-2911, or visit the website at mulberryhealth.com. Mulberry Health, your experience, our calling.
Well, Mark, Noblesville's backup quarterback last year, Ben Easters, is now the now the starting quarterback for Brownsburg. And he is 9 out of 19, nine out of 9 in the first half, 189 yards, en route to a 35-0 lead over Southport. So it looks like probably you're going to see Brownsburg Avon in that sectional championship next week.
Yeah, the Orioles were up 42-0 on Perry Meridian at last. I wonder, John Hart, can he do anything with the program? I mean, does he have any kind of a track record of success at all? It's amazing what he's done at Brownsburg. I mean, he goes up to Chicago, and the school in the Chicagoland area, what, had 60 kids when he got there, and I think 127 in the program when he left. You know what he did at Warren Central. You know what he did at Evansville Wrights. My goodness. His son's not doing bad at Gibson Southern either.
No, not at all. Nick's doing a really good job.
Noblesville continues to deny on the screen. It's something that they worked on all week long, and it's absolutely not there. Dalton Davis puts the exclamation point on it, but Zach Tuane was among those that blew it up at a loss of about 5, which might have been a bit of a generous spot. Motion man, the guy that I think is dangerous, and that's Zion Austin. He's had a good game for them, and they decide to run the football and get that loss back and maybe the length of the football. I'm just happy to see Munoz back. I mean, Mike, that was a pretty pronounced limp when he went off the field in the third quarter, and he's such a valuable part of what they do, and it's great to see him looking like he's at full strength and back in the ball game.
He took a big hit by Zinnick, and Hogan's a pretty good backup quarter running back. But as you mentioned, Munoz has had a great game tonight.
Big third down and 10. He's trying to get a big chunk, and it is picked off by the Noblesville Millers. Back there playing center field with a great return is Justin Johnson-Sparks, who's been picked on plenty tonight. And he gets some measure of revenge with the interception and the return to the 30-yard line.
That's the first mistake all game long that Grimes has made. The ball underthrown.
He was looking for Brian Jenkins there on the deep route. Actually had two receivers in the area, which drug three defenders there. And how much of a rarity is that? How about that's just the sixth interception on the season in over 250 attempts to go along with 42 touchdowns. He doesn't make a mistake like that very often. And matter of fact, Mike, I don't know that he had a really good grip on the ball because it was fluttering a lot through the air. That's not his usual crisp pass for sure. So, can Noblesville take advantage of it? Gremmel with the low snap. That always affects the timing of things, Mike, and a wise move there to just chuck it out of bounds. Groover well covered up.
I'm not quite sure what you do at this point, whether you have Gremmel go under center, because it's just happened too many times. It's just happened too many times. It's really cost their offense momentum. But they continue to run out of that pistol.
Yeah, off a turnover too, Mike. It just the momentum that you're trying to glean, it's hard to keep it. That was a good clean snap, and they run the draw to Blevins. Blevins slips around one tackle, then another. Good run for him inside the 20 to about the 19.
Blevins used the opportunity to hesitate and allow that aggressiveness to come through as he took a look at 45 there. Chandler got right by him and a good run. And now all of a sudden the Millers have another first down. They're inside the red zone.
Nagoda, Davis, Plecker, the guys that kind of bottled up backside blocking and gave him a bit of a running lane off of that draw. So first and 10 for the Noblesville Millers inside the 20 to about the 19. Jeff is showing blitz. They bring the house, the keeper. That's probably the best call there if you're Gremmel. I don't know that much else positive could have happened there.
And for Lafayette, Jeff, you have to be aggressive. You have to continue to be aggressive in this football game. Don't let them control the line of scrimmage. And there, look at 24 Wyatt doing a good job getting in the backfield for the Broncos, along with 19 Monroe.
A loss of one, so a great call defensively by Lafayette, Jeff. 7 points the deficit for Noblesville. See those receivers dispatched to the left side. Wyatt Blades is lined up in the slot with Zach Gruber on the outside. The pocket collapses and he's able to break free from the initial attack, but then the numbers just get to be too much. And who's in the middle of it again? DeMarco Cross. I think Gremmel, and especially that left tackle over there, Garrett Plecker, might see DeMarco Cross when they wake up in the middle of the night.
Not only that, that right side of the Noblesville offensive line is not being able to handle Monroe, number 19, rushing the quarterback. He forced Gremmel to move up in the pocket to create that sack. He's been all over the football field. But again, Jeff, attack the line of scrimmage.
That three-man front that they've used in this particular defensive set has resulted in a loss of five in the last two carries. They set up the screen, and boy, is it defended well. Britton Chandler, the middle linebacker, we said we haven't called his number a lot, but he's been a disruptive force, and we call his number at a time when they really, really needed it, because if not for that block, that ball's not knocked away, they're one block to the end zone. So, Jack Knight attempting a 40-yard field goal, gutting to hold cleverly the long snapper. Interesting call. Really interesting call. But he nailed it.
That's good.
Makes it 28-24 with 7:40 left.
And it's exactly where Noblesville wants to be.
Yeah.
They're within one score now of taking the lead over the Broncos if they can score a touchdown. And it puts a little bit more pressure on the Jeff offense.
And, you know, given the conditions, I mean, as we mentioned, you know, Andy Cleverly with the snap, Connor Gutting got it down, and Jack Knight. That was a no-doubter. He was 2-4 on the season for field goals. He's 10-10 coming into play with point afters. And as we mentioned, he's averaged about 40 yards per punt. So he offers them an effective choice in terms of the effective option, rather, in terms of the kicking game. One urban campus, more than 350 academic programs, award-winning Indiana University and Purdue University degrees. Visit iupui.edu. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise. And again, the heartiest of fans. And it looks, do my eyes deceive me, Mike, or does it appear as though it's finally dried up a little bit? I would imagine it doesn't feel great.
It doesn't
there,
feel great.
It doesn't feel great.
It does appear that the rain has stopped.
That's awesome. Well, I'm particularly happy, too, for the folks that are giving us the outstanding shots down on the field. And thanks for all of your work and your efforts tonight, bringing folks great shots and giving us good second and third looks at some of these plays tonight. The folks behind the scenes that make all of this possible and make our job so enjoyable and so much easier, for sure.
Well, Noblesville got a break there for the first time off that kick. And there is a Jeff player lying down at about the 37-yard line. I'm not sure who that is, Mark, but it doesn't look good.
That's very odd, because there just wasn't a lot of contact. Didn't look to be a lot of contact here. This injury timeout brought to you by Indiana University Health, committed to providing the best care for Indiana families. Indiana University Health is the most comprehensive healthcare system with a personalized approach. Our sports medicine providers deliver high-quality care to soft tissues, bones, and joints. To schedule an appointment, call 765-448-8000 or visit iuhealth.org/arnett. And we always encourage you to patronize the sponsors that you hear and see listed during our shows, because they are making an investment in our youth and in high school athletics, and they make all of this possible. And patronize them, and please express your appreciation for their support of high school athletics at all levels. It's a great time of the year. I mean, we've got soccer state championships going on this weekend. I think cross-country semi-states maybe this weekend, along with volleyball. Of course, Worthing Arena, the home for the volleyball state championships. I've had the pleasure of being a part of that a few times. And always special when tournament time rolls around, be it fall, winter, or certainly in the spring. Right, no question.
Jalen Monroe is the Jeff Rocco coming to the sideline. Let's take a look at him right there, number 19. He's had a tremendous football game. Defensively, he's going to go under the tent and take a look at.
Three-man front, not much pressure. Grimes going to keep it, a rare carry for him, but a positive outcome as he picks up five. Kenja Jenkins, as we said, a pretty active interior lineman. A fumble recovery, a couple of sacks, six tackles for loss, 47 assists, and 28 solo tackles coming into play. A run this time by Munoz as they decide to get a bit more conservative on this offensive set as Lafayette Jeff. And quite frankly, Mike, I don't think Noblesville minds that.
Not at all.
Third down and three. Pat Shanley said he wouldn't mind a few big drives in the ball game. A great second effort's going to result in a first down. The initial contact looked like they'd stopped him short, but he kept the legs driving, slipped out of one defender, and got across the 30-yard line, which is all he needed. Watch this second effort and a good seal block on the outside, and just a good second effort and keeps the legs driving. And also, you can tell they worked on that press, teaching those running backs to fall forward. Mike, that's huge because you pick up a good extra yard or two. Grimes again on the keeper, and it shows a lot of strength in eluding one would-be tackler, but is finally, once he escapes Groover, is chased out of bounds.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Lafayette Jefferson, Grimes runs out of bounds to stop the clock, and that's exactly what Noblesville wanted on this play because they forced him into a loss of three here.
As we mentioned, you know, Shanley said, Coach Shanley told me earlier this week, he said, you know, we like those big plays, but, you know, some sustained drives wouldn't be bad either because of how stingy Noblesville can be with the football. Pass intended on the slant for the slot receiver, and a misfire on that brings up a third down and 13.
And Justin Johnson Sparks, number two for Noblesville, was also in position there to pick off the football there. And Jeff's got to be very careful about handling the ball here late in the ball game.
Bishop Johnson, we haven't called his number much. I mean, he's lined up as a slot receiver. He's 20 catches on the season, right at 300 yards and four touchdowns, but misfire there to him. Third and 13, big down for Noblesville, but something about the play that's called and the alignment that Noblesville has defensively does not please Lafayette Jeff, so they take a timeout. So, not over yet. 6 minutes remaining in this one, and you see 28-24, Lafayette Jeff leading Noblesville.
This is the dawn of an old day, because AT&T and DirecTV are offering yesterday's technology today. TV from space.
Space.
As long as it's not too rainy.
Rainy.
Or windy.
Windy.
Or there isn't a branch in the way.
Branchy.
Welcome to the moment no one's been waiting for.
The fastest internet and the best TV experience is already here with X1, only from Xfinity.
Boqua is athletics, aquatics, and exercise put together in a fun, effective package that allows you to get in great shape safely, effectively, with a bunch of friends.
It is a low-impact exercise. It's not hard on your joints.
It helps me with my balance. It helps me keep my muscles flexible.
If I could do it 5 nights a week, I probably would.
Well, while we were away, got back to action. Munoz with the football is knocked out of bounds about 2 yards. A little pass out the flat. Receivers do a pretty good job of engaging, but just had a lot to make up there. Had 13 to get, and he's only credited with getting 11, so not risking it here. I think Pat Shanley is going to let his defense go to work, and it appears as though he's indeed going to kick it away.
This is going to be the biggest kick of the season for Lafayette Jeff right now.
Jenkins will handle those duties, and Zach Groover will be the return man. So Jenkins.
Wow.
That is a nice punt. It's a boomer, but Gruber, he did not touch the football that rolls inside the 20 to about the 17, and it's knocked out of bounds. I don't think he touched it.
I don't think so either, but I think the Lafayette Jefferson Broncos sidelines was trying to set it up as if he had touched the football.
Well, you've got nothing to lose by acting as though that's what happened. No, I don't think it hit him, and you can tell by his response, but, you know, fortunately it went out of bounds, but you got to give credit where credit's due. A guy that's typically known for his receiving abilities, Brian Jenkins, gets off a booming punt there. We mentioned his long of 58. He exceeded that earlier tonight, but in 21 attempts, he came in averaging 33 yards a punt. That's right, I said 21 attempts. That's not a lot considering how many games they played.
Not a lot. Their offense has been very productive, and again, we knew Noblesville had a really good defense, and they stepped it up a notch here in the second half.
I think this is the drive that has to do it for Noblesville.
This has got to be it.
Yeah, because they can't. I mean, you just with that football team, Lafayette Jeff, you just can't hold them at bay forever. I mean, they're going to make a play.
And if they can't get a couple first downs here, if they force a punt, Mark, Jeff's going to get the ball in pretty good field position.
Yeah, so really, Jeff's defense could set the tone for their offense here with a big stand.
Right now, they could make it happen, but for Noblesville, that short passing game has to be perfect. They've got to find a way to get a good snap and protect the quarterback. He can find receivers.
Not much doing on first down, so it's second and 10. Again, Gremmel throws it out. Pass is complete. Wyatt Blades, as we mentioned, a guy that we've seen a lot on the defensive side of the football, has asserted himself offensively here in this second half. He's got a couple of receptions now as the clock rolls. Noblesville moves the chains to the 32-yard line.
And Noblesville doesn't have to rush anything. Jeff had eight guys in the box there, so why not throw the football?
You see, 5 minutes now, they're showing blitz. They bring a lot. Noblesville, pretty good job of picking it up. They're airing it out up the sidelines. A lot of contact there.
Wow.
Don't see a flag. Pretty good defense all in all. They're letting them play, I'd say.
They are letting them play. At number 14 there, Stephanie, had contact with a receiver downfield. Pretty good throw there by Gremmel.
Yes.
And him and Blades, there's contact. There's no question about it.
There's a lot of, but I think, you know, let me say this. Had it been called, okay.
Yep.
The fact that it's not, okay.
It's okay.
I mean, it's, you know. Yep. I know that Coach Roden may not share that sentiment with us, Mike, but that's that. And, you know, again, just a good high percentage, high possession pass to Wyatt Blades, because they're recognizing, Mike, how soft the corners are playing on the outside. And yes. Why not take
why
that
not?
6 or 7 yard completion if they give it to you?
It's there on the last play, Mark. It wasn't called, but the Noblesville, the left side of their offensive line, got off the ball before the ball was snapped. They were very fortunate there not to be flagged.
I mean, Gremmel right now, you look at the bottom of your screen, he's 14, some 7 yards off the receiver, and he's bailing as soon as the ball's
Chandler.
Down. And what a great play by Chandler.
Wow.
Now, when you need him, we said we didn't call his number a lot in the first half, but boy, the second half, when they have needed big plays. Remember, he blew the screen up earlier, which led to forcing them into a field goal, and then on a big third down right there. I mean,
that is a great play.
Boy.
He just blew that one up for Lafayette Jeff.
I don't, quite frankly,
was a third down.
Yeah, and I don't know how you don't find him somewhere. I mean, you got to get a helmet on him. He's just. Pretty good punt. See if it gets on the ground. That'll help him a little bit, and it does. It rolls away from the return man, and this is going to be a great roll for Noblesville down to about the 10-yard line. However, the clock and the scoreboard in favor of Lafayette Jeff. And, you know, I think if you're Coach Shanley, I think if they're able to hold on here, I think he'll tell you, All in all, I think the second half is good for his football team in terms of it keeping that reality in check. You know what I mean, Mike?
Mm-hmm.
And but you know, it's showing you got to put four good quarters together now that you're in the postseason, because it's a whole different ball game for sure. This time, a bit more success on that screen. They get it to Brian Jenkins, and Noblesville stops it after a gain of five.
And he keeps the ball in bounds. And for Jeff, you don't have to get the play called in real quickly right now. You can start milking the clock.
That's right.
But, Mark, they're not. They're really trying to put the pedal to the metal and trying to push this offense.
Well,
right now, maybe a little bit.
Yeah, the offense is set, and I think they're taking their time getting people in position.
All
and
right,
I, you know,
go.
Ideally, you want that snap around the four-second mark for sure.
There you go.
Yeah, he gets it down to four, and he on the keeper. And again, the good news here is he's keeping it on the ground, keeping it in the field of play. But they need to be careful here on a third and five, Mike, because you're going to give Noblesville some time if you don't convert here on third and five.
At the 16-yard line,
and Noblesville's really good in the middle, so chances are, at this point in the ball game, to run the football on maybe a draw is not going to work. You got to find a way to get the ball in space here to some of your receivers.
And I think because of the style of offense Noblesville runs, that's why they are holding on to their timeouts instead of using them to stop the clock from a defensive standpoint. Now, credit Pat Shanley. He's going to use a timeout here, but he ran that clock all the way down, Mike, as far as he could go before he called that timeout. So some gamesmanship being displayed by coaches on both sides. As we mentioned, the other half of this bracket features Carmel at Westfield. Some of the other teams of note in action tonight, Evansville Modern Day and Linton Stockton, Heritage Christian and Cecina promised to be an interesting matchup. Sheridan at Monroe Central. Bud Wright shows no signs of slowing down at Sheridan. I guess when you have a hamburger named after you, the concession stand, you can coach as long as you want. Now, we mentioned John Hart's son, who's the head coach at Gibson Southern. They're playing Heritage Hills. That's always a rivalry when those two get together. How about Lawrenceburg and Batesville? That's always a good one. Battle of Hendricks County tonight. It's Danville and Tri-West. We know the winner of that one will get Sullivan, who knocked off Monrovia tonight. For Buff at Guerin Catholic, that's one that people had an eye on. And I know that maybe it's not a game that gets a lot of notoriety, Evansville Central at Northview, but, you know, Mark Rates has done a great job over at Northview, Mike. He's the former coach at Terre Haute South and the son of longtime Indiana State football coach Dennis Rates. Dennis helps Mark over there, and Mark, of course, went to Air Force, so that's a nice story over there in Clay County.
I would agree. I saw Northview play 5 or 6 years ago, and they weren't very good.
Third and five. They'll run the jet sweep to Brian Jenkins, and he's
going
to get the corner. Little stop and go move to the 40, and he could be gone.
Wow.
How about that? Brian Jenkins going to put an exclamation point on this night on third and five. What a great call by Lafayette, Jeff.
What a great job by Jenkins on that hesitation on the sideline and great vision. And then he turned to Jets. What a great play there. Let's take a look at this one. Good blocking on the outside there by Munoz, 32.
Oh, Munoz with a seal block that actually sprung him.
Yep.
How about that?
There it is.
And he is off to the races. And no matter how many times you watch him, Mike, he's going to score every time.
Mm.
How about that?
Wow.
He's not bad. He's not bad.
Not bad at all.
And, you know, with all of his prowess catching the football, what a job that he has done running the football tonight, a couple of times that they have run that sweep. Now, ball is down. The kick is up, and it is good. And with 2:24 left, Lafayette Jeff could breathe just a little bit maybe, huh?
Just a little bit, but Noblesville still has some life. They still can find a way to get the ball in the end zone or a field goal. And maybe an onside kick, get the ball back, and another score. But they've got to be precise. And now Jeff is in the driver's seat with just 2 minutes and 23 seconds remaining. And what a tremendous run by Jenkins, as we pointed out. Munoz, a great block out in the flat there for the Broncos offensive unit.
Well, we said that eventually a big play is going to bite you. You've got to make the most of scoring opportunities, and that's exactly what happened there.
Yeah, that's what makes this ball club very difficult to defend against.
I mean, look at the way this is blocked on the edge, though. Yeah. I mean, you know, Munoz with a great steal block. What great vision, though, to plant that outside foot and then get upfield. And then, you know, the last tackler had one shot at him, and that was it. And then he was gone. What a play.
Their offense is explosive. When you can have those kind of skill sets, you have a chance to come back any time that you're behind or have a chance to maintain and milk a lead. So I think Lafayette Jeff has had that advantage tonight in that those skill positions, and that's really paid off for them, despite the fact that I still think that Noblesville has won the special teams war. And frankly, if they get a good kickoff here, who knows how this game could end.
Mike, well, we have an opportunity tomorrow from 12 to 2 at Beech Grove High School, which is, of course, in Indianapolis. They're unveiling Matt English Court. Matt, the longtime AD and basketball coach at Beech Grove, battling brain cancer. And Matt will be there with his wife, Angela, former players, athletic directors, coaches, anyone who's known Matt, associated with him. His slogan is "We Before Me," and he lives it, trust me. And hoping for a great show of support tomorrow as we pay tribute to our good friend Matt English at Beech Grove High School tomorrow. Going to be a day of celebration for sure, and that's exactly the way Matt wants it to be. So those of you watching us that are familiar with Coach English, got friends and has had influences all over the state. I mean, he started coaching at Seeger, he coached at Eminence, he coached at Center Grove, played for Cliff Hawkins, and coached with Cliff Hawkins, the legend. And Matt, of course, has done some just phenomenal things with the basketball program at Beech Grove, along with being the athletic director there. So again, that's at Beech Grove tomorrow from 12 to 2. And Coach, we're thinking about you. Wish you well for sure. So week two of sectional play underway for all of the classes except for this one. This is week number one. Does anyone have anything at all for the Warren Central Warriors? I mean, realistically. I mean, Jason West, David Bell and company, what a football team they have. What would have been interesting is this Warren Central team against last year's Ben Davis team.
Yep.
And that Ben Davis team, quite frankly, was right up there. And even the legend Dick Dullahan himself would tell you that last year's Ben Davis team might have given his national championship team a run for their money. That's how good they were with Reese Taylor and company. And you know, Mike, that team was about 3 years in the making because they were wrecked by injuries and very, very young. And when Reese Taylor and his classmates were sophomores, there were 19 of them playing, and that had never happened before at Ben Davis. And the downside to that is that's put Coach Simmons, the former coach at Noblesville, and not in rebuilding mode, but he has a young football team at Ben Davis for sure.
Yeah, he does. But they're battling tonight with that great Warren Central team. It's 28-21 at halftime. There's an upset in the brewing, by the way. The former football team for this Noblesville head man is losing 7-3 in the third. South Dearborn over East Central. Wow, look at this.
Little throwback. And that will not turn out the way that they had planned, but it's what you got to try at this time is the throwback to Wyatt Blades. Was down at about the 25-yard line, so... loss of a couple on that attempt as Zach Gruber threw it across. And as we mentioned, Wyatt Blades was the recipient there. So, you know, a 10-11-point hole now, for Noblesville. As they see the clock working against them with 2 minutes and 17 seconds left to play.
Well, final score, Triton Central, pretty good ball club. Knocked out Knightstown tonight, 20-0. Mooresville over Richmond 48-21, and Center Grove drills Columbus North 42-0.
Mike Gillen tied for the Mid-State Conference Championship as the deep ball is picked off.
That could be it.
And that should do it, as the interception by Jonnell King puts the exclamation point on it once and for all, if you will. But last year, Mike, the Mooresville Pioneers were at 1-0-8 in the Mid-State Conference, and they come back to tie for the conference championship this year. Mike Gillen in the Indiana Football Hall of Fame, and has over 300 wins in his career at Tri-West, and then, of course, at Decatur Central, built a solid program at Indian Creek, and now a resurrection job at Mooresville High School. And Mike goes back to the days when he and the late Wayne Staley, the longtime coach at Monrovia and Terre Haute North, they were with Dave Enright at Hamilton Southeastern many, many years ago.
Well, I saw Mooresville play earlier this year against Danville, and the Goodman kid who plays quarterback does a really nice job. He's very similar to Grimes here at Lafayette Jeff, because he can wing the football and they can run, and they've got some athletes. They've got some speed, some skill, and Mooresville's a team that you better be careful about in this tournament.
Mike, I'm showing my age. Personal foul charged against Noblesville, but I remember when Carson Goodman was born, because his father and I coached youth league softball and baseball together a long, long time ago in Mooresville, and I'm thrilled for his family for sure. And that's a great story with what Coach Gillen has done at Mooresville High School. And he's just a football coach, Mike. And, I mean, his very first year at Mooresville, my son coaches at Avon Middle School South, and they played a middle school jamboree. And who do you think was there on the sidelines watching the 7th and 8th grade play that day? None other than Mike Gillen. I mean, the varsity football coach was there on a Saturday afternoon seeing what the foundation of his program looked like. And that explains the success. It's like Pat Shanley talked about here. From sixth grade on up, it's their system. We know what Eric Moore's done at Center Grove. From the time a kid puts on a pair of pads in third grade, he's running that wing tee at Center Grove, and that's all they all run all the way up. And that's what it takes to be successful nowadays, for sure.
There's no doubt about it. And, you know, I think for Noblesville, they have a lot to look forward to. And it looks like Justin Roden, his first year, will go down with a loss. But also, having watched some Noblesville youth football, there's a lot of talent in Hamilton County for that ball club to come back and really make a run at some point.
Mike, 4-7 his first year at East Central. He got above 500, I think, was like 8-4 his second year. And then he won a semi-state, he won a regional, and then a state championship. So this is true to form for Justin Roden, a season like he's having this year at Noblesville. And let's not forget your opening comments. Four starters lost to injury, and at least three other primary players on offense and defense who have battled illnesses, including pneumonia, over the past couple of weeks. They came in here a banged-up football team, and he was genuinely concerned, but is, I think, going to go home very, very proud, and rightfully so.
And there's something that you can build on when you can compete here on the road against a really good Lafayette Jeff ball club, who were knocked out last year by Carmel 41-20. Carmel gets by Westfield tonight. It'll be a rematch of that sectional contest. And Lafayette Jeff, with the ability to throw the football and score points, and their defense has a shot.
Kokomo 22-20 over McCutcheon with 4:45 to play. Wow. Getting that update from our good friend Coach Scheib, who used to patrol the sidelines for Noblesville. It's been an interesting ball game, Mike. It's been one of two halves. I got to give a lot of credit to Noblesville. But also, you know, credit Lafayette Jeff for playing well enough to win. I think, especially in this fourth quarter, when they needed big defensive plays, they got it. And we mentioned in the last 5 or 6 minutes that Noblesville had some scoring opportunities that they didn't take advantage of. And you just can't keep – you can't have empty possessions against Lafayette Jeff. They're just too many weapons, and they're just too darn good. Mm-hmm. They'll make you pay, and that's exactly what they did with a long touchdown run by Brian Jenkins. And Munoz, I tell you, he may be a little slower to roll out of the rack tomorrow. I mean, he limped off at one point, looked like he wasn't coming back. But the first half, it just seemed like he was everywhere. Running screens and running the football hard and picking up blitzes, and he's had a really good night for this football team.
Yeah, it's outstanding game by Munoz. And the center has done a really good job tonight for Lafayette Jeff.
Yeah, how about Lennon, DeBoer, May, Nelson, and Richie, that offensive line?
Tremendous.
Mike, that up-tempo, that's not easy for those linemen.
Not at all.
Those guys range, you know, from 230 to 288. I mean, Drew DeBoer at that left guard position, 6'2", 288, and And he's got to have his stuff together in order to be able to run that up-tempo offense.
Talked about one of the keys to the game, Mark, was the play in the trenches, and certainly tonight I think Jeff won the battle in terms of their offensive line. And it is hard for that offensive line in that tempo, throwing the football, running east, west, north, south. But they've done a great job this evening moving the football.
His concern, Justin Roden's, was a big place and multiple offensive formations and their ability to defend them. That essentially was what sealed the deal off of that the jet sweep that they were so successful on with Brian Jenkins. But, on the other side of the football, Coach Bremer came in a bit concerned about Noblesville defensively. And I think those concerns were warranted, especially in the second half. They really slowed that offense down and changed the pace of the game. And I think much of the credit has to go to their defense for that. But let's give credit where credit's due. Their offense was a bit more efficient that second half as well.
No question about it. Now, I mentioned again the center, Dalton May, number 58 for Lafayette Jeff. Great job of snapping the ball tonight. It's been outstanding.
First down carry for Munoz, and that should allow Lafayette Jeff to move on. And I think when all is said and done, I think Pat Shanley will be happy that his ball club got this kind of a test in the second half of Noblesville. I think you'll see a lot of benefit in this moving on to the sectional championship next week. I think the thing that so far that we've talked about with him earlier this week, and Mike, not only do you want to be playing your best football at this time of the year, but it's so very, very important to come into this game with health. That's a luxury not afforded to Justin Roden, but Pat Shanley said he had the full complement of players, and knock wood, they have avoided the injury bug throughout most of the course of the season as Justin Roden decides to spend a timeout here.
Hopefully Monroe, number 19 for Lafayette Jeff, he bounces back. He was dinged up a little bit earlier in the ball game here. I see him standing on the sideline without his helmet. I'm assuming, obviously, he took the helmet off a long time ago, but he had a really nice game.
Defensive side of the football, I like DeMarco Cross tonight for Lafayette Jeff. He was about as active as anyone they had. We didn't call Chandler's numbers a lot, despite the fact that he's the heart and soul of that defense, but two separate occasions they needed big plays, and they got them from him for sure.
Yeah, he came in and did a good job of attacking the line of scrimmage. And, again, if you're aggressive, good things will happen for you. You just cannot sit back and let the other team attack and move the chains. And Lafayette Jeff, when they had to, were able to shut it down.
This is a fairly young football team that Lafayette Jeff has. I mean, Worley and Chandler are seniors at linebacker, but other than that, pretty much underclassmen. I mean, those two guys in the middle, Caden Sowers and Peyton Price up front, they're both sophomores. Price at 6'2", 292. Jenkins is a senior on the offensive side of the football, but again, Munoz and Grimes and Johnson. Zion Austin, we've called him a few times. He's a senior. Most of the experience comes up front with them, Mike. Four out of the five offensive linemen are seniors, with the exception of Lennon, who at 6'2", 224 is a sophomore, that left tackle. But, again, a lot of youth for a very good Lafayette Jeff football team.
Well, timeout's called, and the reason why, you have to figure it's a teaching moment. And this is what high school football is all about. It's education-based. It's always teaching, and it should be. If you can't teach the game, regardless of when you're losing, the kids aren't going to experience and growth. And that's what I think both coaches want out of this ball game. They want their programs to grow.
There are some coaches that will tell you that not going to change that. Let's get on a bus and go home. But traffic control, Mike. We'll call it traffic control. That's what. And occasionally you will see it, Mike. Obviously, coaches will call that timeout. Even the ones that are on the short side of the scoreboard, they'll do that to give a chance to give those seniors one more chance to get off the field and let people pay them a little tribute. But I don't blame Justin Roden for wanting this season to last as long as it possibly can. I get that, because for Noblesville, as a coach, I could tell you as a former coach, one of the worst days of the year for me for many reasons was equipment turning. I always hated it, and that's what Noblesville will have to face now as Lafayette Jeff will move on The Broncos saw the Noblesville Millers stiffen mightily in the second half. And at 35-24, they could breathe a huge sigh of relief as they move on to the Sectional 4 championship game. Meanwhile, now the postseason assessment starts for the Noblesville Millers as they close the season 4-6. And we'll be back.
Oh, that pass is deep and open, and it's going to be a touchdown.
Nice cut by Maxwell, getting behind a block. He's going to take it in.
He's got a man. He's wide open. Can he get free? He's going to be gone.
He only has one touchdown and 2 yards out.
That one is up 29.
Across the middle, he's got a man wide open across the 40. He is all alone, and he could take it all the way. Touchdown, Blue Devils.
65
on the
yards.
ISC Sports Network.
New. It's a sign of growth. A fresh start and full of possibilities. There's nothing like new. Introducing the new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. The brand new Riverview Health Westfield Hospital, now open. Riverview.org.
Boqua is athletics, aquatics, and exercise put together in a fun, effective package that allows you to get in great shape safely, effectively with a bunch of friends.
It is a low impact exercise. It's not hard on your joints.
It helps me with my balance. It helps me keep my muscles flexible.
If I could do it 5 nights a week, I probably would.
People always tell you what not to do. Don't go too fast. Look, but don't touch.
Professor Mohan.
Don't ask questions.
How do we help startups succeed?
So for startup companies, the objective isn't profit.
Don't wake the neighbors. Find out what you can do. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise.
Pretty special, right? Where else can you get this?
No, pretty much anywhere.
What?
What? Oh, yeah, no, I meant Xfinity On Demand. You get it on all your devices, anytime, anywhere. But yeah, this you can only get here. Dude, where's your horse?
Who cares?
Awesome is having the most TV shows and movies anywhere with Xfinity On Demand.
Welcome back, Mark James, Mike Walensky. There you see the final at 35-24. Jeff moves on. What a dandy second half we saw. Riverview Health Westfield Hospital is now open, featuring the area's first combined ER and urgent care. Right size, right care, right here. To learn more, visit riverview.org. IUPUI, Indiana University, and Purdue University degrees from one urban campus. Visit iupui.edu. IUPUI, fulfilling the promise. Boqua Aquatic Fitness, an exercise program combining aquatics, athletics, high-intensity interval training. It's a water workout your body will love you for. Grab your bogs and get wet. The city of Noblesville. The city of Noblesville is Miller proud. Go Millers. Welcome to our post-game wrap-up here at Lafayette. Jeff, make Pepe's your choice for your pre-game or post-game celebration. Bring your friends and family. Enjoy selecting from our very extensive menu of wonderful tasting authentic Mexican dishes. 2525 Sagamore Parkway in the Tippecanoe Mall parking lot. Pepe's Mexican Restaurant. Time now to take a look at the Noblesville defensive play of the game. Again, brought to you by the city of Noblesville. Go Millers. And appropriately enough, Noblesville defensively was able to be a little stingy. A rare miscue by Max Grimes, and Noblesville was able to take advantage of it.
Yeah, nice pick there by the corner for the Millers, Justin Johnson Sparks, a 5'11", 150-pound senior, and put the Millers into scoring position there and a chance to get back in the ball game. At the time, they were just down 7. They did cut the lead down to 4 at 28-24, but here's another look. It's Sparks with a big interception as you take a look at him with the left hand, and big gain, turnaround, field flipped. Noblesville got the ball deep into Jeff Terry, but they never find the end zone there and had to finish with a field goal, but yet they hung in the ball game and they really had a good second half.
A big pick for him, most assuredly, and they had picked on him plenty in the first half, but he did a good job of doing what they say. He stayed over the top of the receiver, Mike, and then when he saw the ball was underthrown a little bit, he was able to make the adjustment. How about tonight's big play of the game by Power and Tell? And let's face it, Mike, the big play of the game came, I think, when Lafayette Jeff needed to flat put it away. Brian Jenkins, a guy, is such a great receiver, and he did a good job, with kicking the football in the special team side. But when they needed a big run, he got some blocks to seal the corner. And again, the receiving core outstanding job of blocking all night long.
A great job of blocking downfield by the Broncos. Marquise Munoz, the running back, out in the flat, and you see the speed that Brian Jenkins has. He's clearly a great runner north-south. He's got some great moves, great hands as well. At 6'2", 182 pounds, but now he's got 17 touchdowns, and he's a kid that we're going to see him on Saturday. He's playing college football at a high level.
We mentioned the diversity. Munoz running the football. Grimes occasionally running the ball well. Zion Austin, the slot receiver. He was a contributor from time to time. Matthews and Jenkins are the big guns. Even Bishop Johnson got into the act. When you mention all of that, you put all of that together, it makes you very tough to defend. But speaking of defending, how about the credit goes to – oftentimes when you see a high-potent – a high-scoring offense like this, it gets lost how good they are defensively, and they are good defensively.
Yeah, Noblesville's very good. There's a reason why they came a touchdown away from beating an Avon or beating a Brownsburg, but you got to give Jeff a lot of credit for making things happen. They really spread the football around, and they will be meeting up with the Carmel Greyhounds, who knocked off the Westfield Shamrocks tonight 28-7, so that should be an interesting matchup between the Broncos and the Greyhounds for the sectional championship, as you see the Noblesville Millers dejectively walk off the field. And they have everything to think about next year. And next week is coming across for the Broncos.
If for Pat Shanley, are you happy with the test that your ball club got tonight? Do you think this was a good test for them?
Well, internally I might be happy, but externally I want to let the kids know that there's still a lot of improvement to be made, and we still need to clean up our special teams. We need to do a better job, conditioning, and we need to work on that for the next couple of days and get ready for a really tournament-tested Carmel team, and we have to believe that we can win. If they believe that they can win, they've got the chance to come home with a victory.
Yeah, and as we mentioned, a little bit of history here. 5A sectional titles in 89, 91, and 02. Sectional championships at 3A in 81 and 82. And Pat Shanley tells his kids, if you want to be a marquee name and you want to get looks, he said, I have a lot of kids here that I don't understand why D1 coaches can't find them. So I've just told our kids, you got to make a big tournament run, a deep tournament run, and you got to get on a big stage. And, Mike, let's face it, their best opportunity to do that is next week against Carmel.
Yeah, Carmel gives you a big stage at Class 6A because of their success and certainly because of the kinds of kids that they have in their programs. I know that they have a number of kids who are Division I prospects already committed, and so this is a good opportunity for the Jeff Broncos, and they know at 9-1 that they're on a roll. They have a lot of confidence coming in the ball game, and they just need to, again, clean up a few things, work really hard this week, and make some things happen. When you got a guy like Grimes quarterbacking, you got a chance.
What do you take away from this game if you're Noblesville and Justin Roden?
Well, I think with Noblesville, you know that when you can continue to work and be together, good things happen, and you can limit turnovers, then you've got a chance. And tonight, whether it's a center snap or a few plays here and there, the difference was made there. And you can continue to work at things, you continue to work, good things happen, and they're really close. They are really close. So a year's time, they've got a lot of youngsters on their roster, they'll have a chance to make a run in next year's tournament.
Lastly, partner, I know you've had a ball throughout the course of this season. First football game I've been able to do this year. I'm happy to be busy for the rest of the tournament. But more than anything else, as we mentioned, our history goes back to way back to 2000, and we keep in touch throughout the course of every year. But certainly an honor, a privilege, and a pleasure to be back in the broadcast booth with you tonight.
Well, I enjoyed it as well. And it is a small world because John Mundell, who's one of the key coaches for the Lafayette Jet Broncos, comes out of the Cathedral family, and I'm very happy for John, and certainly familiar with the Noblesville group, and knowing that Noblesville has been inspired quite a bit this year, I understand, from a young man named Nash Huffman, an individual with Down syndrome and a senior at Noblesville who really provides a lot of spirit for this ball club.
Our production staff, among the best of the business. Thanks to the guys with the camera for giving us great shots all night. From Mike Walensky, I'm Mark James.